नमस्ते मैडम। नमस्ते नमस्ते।
नमस्ते सर।
नमस्ते नमस्ते। ऑल द वेरी बेस्ट टू यू।
थैंक यू सर। ಈಗ ತಲುಪಿದ್ದು ಕೊಡಗಿಂದ।
ಓಹೋ, ರಿಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್ 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 ರಿಲ್ಯಾಕ್ಸ್। ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಡು ವೆಲ್, ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಡು ಅಂಡ್ ಪ್ರೋಗ್ರಾಮ್ ವಿಲ್ ಗೋ ವೆಲ್, ನಥಿಂಗ್ ಟು ವರಿ।
2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್ 2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್ ಸರ್ 2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್
ಫೈನ್ ಫೈನ್।
ಡೌನ್ ಡೌನ್
ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಗಿವ್ ಮೀ ಅ ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ಕಾರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಮಾರ್ಕೆಟ್ ಫಿನ್ನ। नमस्कार।
ಕೀಪ್ಯಾಡ್ ನೆಕ್ ತೆಗಿಯಮ್ಮ ಅದ್ ಇದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಇಟ್ಟು ಪ್ರೆಸ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಅದೇನಾದ್ರೂ ಹೋಗ್ಬಿಟ್ರೆ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಅದೊಂದು ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಮ್ ಆಯ್ತದೆ ಹಂಗೆ.
नमस्ते राचप्पा, नमस्ते राचप्पा जी, नमस्ते. ग्रेट पिलर बिहाइंड द बिहाइंड दिस पर्टिकुलर एक्ट इज मिस्टर राचप्पा नंजप्पा नंजप्पा.
ನಿಮ್ಮ ಆಶೀರ್ವಾದ.
ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಗ್ರೇಟ್, ವಾಟ್ ಎ ಗ್ರೇಟ್ ಮೂಮೆಂಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್.
ಮೊನ್ನೆ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ ವೀಕ್ ನಿಮ್ಮ ಊರಿಗೆ ಬಂದಿದ್ದೆ ಸರ್.
ಆಹಾ,
ಬಿಜಾಪುರ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗಿ ಬಂದೆ.
ಹೌದ್ರಿ? ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ ಓಕೆ.
ಬಾಗಲಕೋಟೆಗೆ ಹೋಗುವಾಗ ನಿಮ್ಮನ್ನ ಬಹಳ ಎಂಜಾಯ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು ಹೋದೆ.
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಸೋ ಮಚ್, ಸೋ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಯು. ಯಾ, ಅದರ 2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್, ಅದರ 2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್.
ಎಸ್ ಸರ್, ಚಾಯ್ ಅದರ 2 ಮಿನಿಟ್ಸ್.
ಯಾ, ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು
ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಯು.
ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ ಮಾಡಿ.
ನಮಸ್ತೆ
ನಮಸ್ತೆ ನಮಸ್ತೆ ನಮಸ್ತೆ.
ಆಗೋದಿಲ್ಲ ನಂಬರ್ ಸಾಕಾಗಲಿ. Clip it, clip this, and get this ready.
You can.
ಅನ್ಕೋಬಿಡು ಅನ್ಕೋಬಿಡು. ಸ್ಟಾರ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡಿಯಲ್ಲ
Pleasant evening to one and all present here. We will start the program in another 5 minutes' time. It's my great pleasure to welcome our distinguished guests and delegates for this online workshop on empowerment and opportunities for global women entrepreneurs in food sector, which is jointly organizing by Association of Women in Commerce and Industry and Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, Ministry of Food Processing Industries, Government of India. Just now, we received a message from our Honorable Minister's office, who is the chief guest for today's event. Ma'am will be joining soon. So meanwhile, we will start the program with a technical talk from Director IAFPT, Dr. C. Ananda Ramakrishnan, sir. Anytime ma'am will join us, that time we will start with the formal inaugural session. So may I now request Dr. C. Ananda Ramakrishnan, sir, Director, Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, to deliver a technical talk on sustainable technologies for the Indian food industry. Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Sunija, respected Chaya Nanjappa ma'am, Parul,
Mr. Parul sir and Ayoji ma'am and Dr. Mageshwar sir and Dr. Sridevi ma'am, Batrinath sir and Grace Mohan sir, good evening to everyone. And we got that just now, we received this message, so we are starting with the technical sessions and we'll stop when madam will join. Maybe she's, madam is in another meeting, that's what we got a news. So I'll start with my technical session. Yeah, today I like to give a talk on the sustainable technologies for Indian food processing industry. And if you look at Indian food processing industry is doing a tremendous job for the last almost now 10 years, and almost 10% of our growth rate recent past, and even during the pandemic, this the one industry is not all shown any negative growth. Instead of that, it's shown the positive growth. And especially if you look at the ready-to-eat, ready-to-cook product, it has gone beyond the imagination of more than 35% increase in the market demand. If you look at the scenario, what is happening in this system, what the food itself, like 100 years back, we used to take food for the energy. 50 years back, we started taking food for nutrition. Now people are looking at food for soul. When they wanted to eat, they wanted to enjoy, they wanted to get a pleasure, and how they wanted to move on to that. And people wanted a customization, personalized nutrition and personalized food and different novel product. For example, Sonic enhanced food. When they deliver the food, they wanted to listen to the music. That can enhance, but earlier how we used to take the food. First, smell will come and hit in your nose. Your eye will go and see the appearance of the food. And the touch, mostly in Indians, we use the touch feeling as well. Our hand touch with the food. That sensitizes and it goes to your tongue and the taste it comes. Now ears also play in the role. That's what the novel range of the product. They wanted to enjoy with the sound along with the food. One study in the UK, when they deliver the fish along with the seesaw sound, it is enhanced 3 times higher intake of the fish. So that's what people wanted to fine tune the food molecules and food itself. That type of product, the customer's preference is going on. Ethical food choice and the brand trust. It's never been such a center stage in the food business or food whole ecosystem. Now people wanted to be responsible. And if they are responsible, they wanted to buy the product that from the responsible company, and that brand trust, that how to build the whole brand itself. That's what consumers wanted. How to make the consumer preference food? That is the quite big challenge. If you look at the statistics from the 2020 and very recently released the statistics, what we are doing at 2016, 82% people wanted a clean and natural ingredient. What went on to the 2020, it is increased to 86%. And price, earlier it was 24%. People wanted to see that price as the key element to buy the any product. Now it's a decrease to the 17%. People are not bothered about the price. They wanted to go for the clean, natural, and the good health claim product. That's what it is indicates. And the 50% people wanted 2016, the natural claims, like pure, organic, all these claims, it is went down to 64%. That may be the contribution from the COVID, and that's what people wanted to go for the non-GMO foods, organic, and all the pure form alternative to salt, sugar, such type of product, the natural products. And then recognizable ingredient. This is the another area now people wanted to see that the product labeling, they wanted open labeling in the system. They don't want to hide anything in the label what you put it. The 56% wanted in the 2016 go for seeing the ingredient what is used in the product. Now it's went down to 68%. It clearly indicates people are going beyond the product taste and the company. They wanted to see that each and every component in the food, including the labeling. In this background, if you look at what are the technology can input can help sustainability of Indian food processing industries, I talk most on the Indian side, and we'll see that how best we can play in the global stage. One is the technologies for the market demand product. What are the product its demand in the local as well as the outside market. Another technological upgradation, because existing technology, suddenly we can't change in the new thing. What are the upgradation? We can do it or fine tune with the existing technologies. And one more thing is the waste utilization. We need to look very close into that, because right now we are producing the quite lot of the product. For example, what the wastage is generating throughout the globe is 3 billion tons of the product is whatever produces a wastage. 1/3 of the product is gone for the wastage. But how to minimize that one, how to utilize that one? So we need a proper technological guidelines and also how to use it. And food packaging is the important one, because that's play the major role. Design of the packaging films from the labeling to the details in the food packaging, and food safety and supply chain management, and application of computational modeling, artificial intelligence, and IoTs. These are the 6 elements. If you put together, definitely our Indian food industry may sustain, and the technological input can help to improve their product. What is the market demand right now? People are always talking about vegan food and plant-based meat and all. This is the one success story. You can see the Beyond Meat. It is the very small startup company started in the 2009. Recently, they signed MOU with the PepsiCo. And 2019, they released the product Beyond Fried Chicken. It is a purely based on vegetarian. Can you imagine? KFC is releasing the product with a totally vegetarian source. It's like a same texture, that structure, and a taste. All these things built in this Beyond Meat, beef, and all the product has been released as close what it is there in the meat. Because people wanted to go away from the meat because of the COVID background, or they wanted to go veganized. So that case, they wanted to taste it, because some people already tasted, some people wanted to taste like that, because they enjoy such type of taste and that pleasure what they are getting, the eating the meat. So that's what this company is dominated. One more company, Redefined Meat, recently, like 2018, they made 3D printed meat. You look at the 3D printed meat, it's as good as what is the meat structure, the steak, what they did it. We, IFPT also, we are working on the similar kind of structural, because you need to texturize the protein. That is the key element here. If you're able to texturize the protein, then you can put it all the fiber element to create such type of structure. But we need a proper printer, like a 3D foot printer. Then the combination of the fiber and the fat molecule, how you texturize the protein, can create such type of structure we can able to create. That's what this market demand continuously increasing, that we are expecting more than 6% in Indian demand also is increasing. Alternative meat analogs, you can look at, so many companies are coming up, and outside demand also is going very high. If you look at how we can create it, we can take it a legumes, cereals, most of the things. If you take it the product like rice, 31% wastage. The broken rice is coming 31% from our milling. Pulse, all these 28%. Vegetables, we are getting almost close to 23 to 25%. So we can take all these things, we pack it, and we can do. We can do it two type of technologies. One is that extrusion technology. That's what most of the people used to do. And the spinning we can do, and the 3D printing. These are the technology. 3D printing is a combination of these two things. But how to create that texture and the structure, that is the key element. And it's a permeable emulsifiers. If you use it, it's possible to create such type of meat analog. These technologies need to be developed, and we need a lot of input to develop such type of technologies to reach out the market beyond what we are thinking. And another product, if you see that market segment, is our own coconut. And see that coconut demand. India is the third country next to Indonesia and Philippines. India stands third in the production of the coconut nuts. But we are not doing the business what Indonesia or Vietnam is doing. Still, we are using the local consume of our coconut nuts. If you look at the coconut, the reach, the food, beverages, cosmetic. Cosmetic is the highest among the coconut oil, mainly MCT oil. If you look at that percentage wise, 2018 and 2026, the gap is too widened. Among the food items, food and beverages, beverages is dominating in the coconut segment. Among that, coconut water is highest, next is the coconut oil, and third is coconut milk, last is a dried coconut as a desiccated coconuts. we never expected coconut water will take this type of center stage than even coconut oil. The demand, very recent past, coconut water demand is continuously in the rise. So how to make it a technological input to convert our whatever produced from our nuts, the coconut water into that? That you see that the segment is growing at the 14%. It's not that simple. So we are producing the world number third, but we are not doing much in the coconut products. I'll give the one simple example of coconut water market potential. If you look at this one, this is the one company that is that Aegis company. They are climbing. It's not our climb. They are climbing. They are 5:1 ratio against to competition. But what? Why that is makes so special? They are claiming no GMO, sugar free, and the cultivation. Because maybe where I'm touching the point is, when we wanted to cultivate our coconut trees, what happened? 5 years it takes to produce the coconut nuts. And what is our farmers are getting? Per tree, per year, only 1,500 rupees. The 5 years of input, finally we end up at only 1,500 our farmers are getting. But we use the fertilizers. We have to accept that because our conditions we try to use. But we need to understand this residual solution should not go to the coconut water. But that type of trees is better. Then the third point is they use the cold filtered one. Oxygen free of the production process they used, and that's a patented technology. They are not told which is the technology they used, but finally the technologies makes this product is the popular product. And look at the organic coconut water. But one more thing we need to understand, when we wanted to go for the outside country, the certification is the key element. Now like a rainforest certificate type of the certifications, if you make it better, because they have to, and organic certificate, US certification is given by the organic US FDA. Such type of certification makes credibility of your company, then we can reach out larger market in the outside our country, including the inside country. That growth rate of the organic coconut is going for the 15%, and South African market is one of the fastest growing in this segment, and consumption of the organic coconut in UK gone 25 to 26 million liters per year. It's a huge market is created. And one more thing, the coconut sugar, what produced from the Vietnam is the dominating throughout the globe. That is one of the leading coconut sugar exporter in the globe, the small country. But we are also producing the coconut sugar and the Nida sugar, but we are unable to capitalize the market. Maybe the one reason, what is that Vietnam sugar is the GA. GA is around, they are climbing around 35 to 45. Our glycemic index of our coconut sugar comes around 45 to 55. That's what we need to know how best we can utilize that on. And coconut milk, we can't replace whatever the God creation of our dairy milk. But if you wanted to make it artificial milk from the either coconut or soya, rice, hemp, chia, even not oats, we need to play with the emulsions. So when you wanted to create an emulsions, the ionic strength and how they replace each other, and we need to avoid the phase separation of flocculation, it is a great challenge. If you're able to do that, reduce the your surfactant level when you use the natural surfactant, and the keeping the storage stability and more than 4 months, is really we are the great winner in this line. So we need to think alternative to dairy milk. And now a lot of things are going on. Other than dairy milk, we can't use the milk name, but still, it comes, we have to think how best we can utilize it. Coconut oil market, as I said, is one of the, always is the driving force, either India and outside. Either if you look at the growth rate, is a 4.3% in the coconut oil, virgin coconut oil, moving on to 10%. But one area is the medium chain triglyceride. This is the wonderful molecule. But still, a lot of scope is there, extraction of the MCT oil, how to use it. You compare with the other oils like a butter or palm oil, coconut oil has the highest amount of the medium chain fatty acids, because this is the directly it's a digest in the liver. It creates the ketone in the ketone that will help for our brain development. That is the USP of moving on to the MCT oil extraction. And this ingredient can be used in the other systems. So we can play one thing, raw oil or the virgin coconut oil, you wanted to go still down, you can extract the ultra processing like a MCT oil extraction and moving into the food ingredient market. Now people, this is the statistics released by the IFT and the 2020. 50% of the population in US wanted to buy the healthy and superfoods. If you look at the list of the superfoods like non-dairy milks, what we discussed, green tea is the wonderful tea. It has the catechins, it gives a lot of benefits for health, and turmeric and black garlic. If you see the spice itself, India is the highest producer of the spice and highest consumers and highest exporters. And whatever the international organization listed total number of 107 spice list, India is producing 75 out of that. And the turmeric, even recent past, if you look at the Thoothukudi port, they smuggled the turmeric. That much demand is gone. That because of the curcumin, people are believing this is a very immune boosting compound, other things. And hemp, a lot of people are now using the hemp seeds. What they are thinking, like if you take it the hemp, they're getting the pleasure. But we don't have the scientific evidence for that. But maybe the reason is a combination of omega-3 and omega-6 percent in the hemp. That maybe the people wanted to move on to that. There's a good amount of the proteins are there. And chia seed, and CFTRI has released chia seeds, and a lot of work has been done in CFTRI regarding the chia seed, or that omega-3 fatty acids, good amount of omega-3 fatty acids. It has the proteins, and it can be easily convertible in the food molecules. And quinoa and millets, and look at the last one is millets, our own superfoods. We need to promote. Another 2 years time, we are going to celebrate year of millets for the United Nations. That time we need to promote. Why can't millet can be promoted as a superfoods? That means first we have to take it the millet. And we understand a lot of issues are there, the millet processing, yes, the storage problem is there, and the palatability and other things that can be easily sorted out. All the research institution like CFTRI and IFPT and Indian Institute of Millet Research, they're working on it. But this is the time we need to promote our own millets. Think about coconut and other product, other countries also producing. And millets, our soils, easily it is cultivatable, and easily we can promote. One, our trump card is the millet of the future. We have to promote heavily on the millets so we can feed it throughout the globe with the millets. So superfoods, yes, millet is the, we have to consider the one of the superfoods apart from our spices. This is the what I said about initial time, the ethical food choice. Recently, like last year, one of the famous company, mobile phone company, launched the new phone. They didn't provide the charges. They said, we are the environmental responsible company. That's what people wanted to know, because I am a responsible citizen. I follow all the government of India's rules, but I wanted to see what I'm buying the product. That company also obey all the regulations of the world. There should be a responsibility. There should be a transparency and fair trade practice, fair payment, and then gender disparity and low, less carbon footprint. All these things, they have to do that. And how do you know that? We have the fair trade certifications, lot of certification, third party certifications are there. They can come and certify your company. Yes, you are doing all the things ethically, your food is manufactured. They certify, yes, we are willing to pay even extra amount. That's what in US, 4 people out of 10, they wanted to buy ethically prepared, ethically manufactured the product. So we need to think, when we wanted to put it our product into the market, we need these third-party certifications. We need to follow our good manufacturing practice. Whatever the labeling, we should not hide anything. They want transparency more than what is required. That's what is the government regulation says. You give more than what is the regulation says in the your labeling. That makes people to buy your product. So that is the way we need to think the future market scope. If you come back to the technological upgradation of my second point of the sustainable development, if you look at our old technologies, the baking, still we are using that more than 50 years. We are using the same ovens, frying, refrigerated, freezing, size reduction, material handling, all these things are used. But most of the our unit operations can go for more than 20 to 30 years without any trouble. But that may not make sense for your product into the market. People want a new way of the product. If you take the example of frying, can we go for the vacuum frying? What it does and what it helps? Can be the oil intake and uptake of the water. That's what we need to see. The product is the less oil. Can we do it with the vacuum frying? That means we need to understand mass transfer coefficient of water transport and oil transport during the frying. vacuum can give. That means what is the technology solution has to go for vacuum frying technologies and the baking. Still now we are unable to deliver the probiotics in the baking because of the baking temperatures goes for the 180 degree temperatures and the 20 minutes because the baking needs that one. But how to use evaporation cooling mechanism takes place in the crumb portion of the bread, can we deliver our biomolecules? That's the challenge that we need to do. That thermal processing is the widely used because most of the food is cooked at the heating temperature. Can we use non-thermal processing? These are the technologies we need to add into that. So definitely we have the edge onto that. For example, I said about drying. Normal drying, cabinet drying, other sun drying, so many drying methods because we wanted to preserve our molecules, our products, we need to dry the moisture. Can we have the alternative? One is the freeze drying is the very good alternative. Now, lot of evening snacks like apple or vegetables, they are freeze dried, some marketed. But still long drying time because of the size and the sublimation rate, the ice, whatever the water content has to be converted as the ice, then the sublimation takes place. Can we control the sublimation rate? Can we enhance the sublimation rate of the ice? What is the alternative to freeze drying? One is the spray freeze drying. It's a combination of spray drying and freeze drying. That can be easily makes the particles like heat sensitive particles like a probiotics and the other molecules, we can make it a powder form. And modified spray drying technology, hydro drying that can be used, refractors windows drying to make a particles more spongy and the more flowable particles we can able to make it. Even if you go for the spray freeze drying, it has shown in the vanillin and DHA oil using such type of matrix, we can make low dense particle. Even we can deliver through the whatever we are going for the lung, bifurcation of lung, it travels very deep into the This is what I said as a modified spray drying technology. We are using the two-fluid nozzle normally. When you wanted to go for the co-delivery, for example, people are telling curcumin and resveratrol. Instead of using the curcumin alone, we can combination of the resveratrol with the curcumin enhances the bioavailability, action will be higher. So how to co-deliver the system? So we can make it a three-fluid nozzle. Just existing nozzle itself, you can make it a one more flow line. Then we can make it a core cell matrix. Even we can go multi-layer encapsulation. You depends on where to deliver. You wanted to deliver the first layer into the mouth. Yes, you can deliver the first layer into the mouth. You can release the whatever the flavor you wanted to release. Then you can take your molecule into the small intestine. Yes, you can put the such a matrix. You wanted to release your molecule into the larger intestine. Yes, it's possible to do. So if we wanted to go such a level, then we need to go for the three fluid nozzle. It is possible to do that. And another one area is nanotechnology. If you see that nanotechnology in the food and agriculture sector, very few countries brought the guidelines. Till now, we don't have any regulations. Even UK 2010, the parliament discussed even 2 days, they are not able to bring regulations for the nano usage in the agri-food sector. But what they have done, most of the countries, they wanted to bring the guideline to see that how it is effective in the system. India brought such a guideline in the last July itself. Department of Biotechnology released the guidelines how to use nano matrix or materials in the food systems. We can go for the forming food product, mainly for forming the pesticides, fertilizer. They're widely used in the sprays and the food processing. We can go for the ingredient, nanoscale reaction, nano patterning, all these things. For example, nano patterning. If you wanted to make it a coffee from the normal coffee, cappuccino, and the espresso coffee. Espresso coffee does not give the foam into that. Cappuccino, it creates the foams, but they use the milk protein to create the foam. Can I get the same foam from the cappuccino? It is possible, but we have to pattern the foam, whatever the existing foam into that. Because it's a naturally surfactant is there in the coffee itself, then you can create the nano patterning. It is possible. The nano patterning technology can be widely used in the, any of the systems, but how do you use it? That are nano sensors and safety of the distribution, consumers and food production, food packaging and retail. These are the areas nanotechnology can be adapted. And look at the anemic country in our country. It's a very sad to see that most of the 50% populations are anemic. And we tried a lot from the last 20 years. We tried to use so many metrics, so many methods. Even recently, you would have heard about Prime Minister's speech during the Independence Day, wanted to use the FRK technique, fortified rice kernel. We wanted to do that. We have done very good success in iron fortifications in the salt. Can we do the similar iodine fortification, the salt? Can we do the similar iron fortification, the rice? But how to do that? It's a big, big challenge because matrix is entirely different. Matrix is different, means solubility is different. Solubility is different, means bioavailability entirely going to change the game. So that's what we need to look any other alternative. If you look at the absorption of micronutrients, except selenium and vitamin C, most of the micronutrients absorbs less than 50%. Iron, it absorbs only 10%. That means how to enhance this 10% to 30% or 40%. That is the challenge. So we need to look, instead of the iron, how to make our system to absorb more than what is right now is absorbing. And see that food nanotechnology enhance the biotechnology, bioavailability. The particle size reduces less than 500 nanometers. Absorption goes close to the 100%. It's a simple calculation. If you think about our intestine as the pipe, when the molecules move inside the pipe, the surface area increases like this smaller size droplet. The surface area increases. When it stays longer in villi and microvilli, it absorbs more. That's what the animal studies are demonstrated. And here, the green tea catechins, what we talked about, is a wonderful molecules of catechins, catechins, epicular catechins, all are there. But what we are getting is a good, like a fight against cancer, diabetes, metabolic disorder, everything is fine. But what we are getting per cup of the green tea, we are getting only 10 milligram of the catechins per cup, the polyphenols we are getting. But what is the absorption pattern? When it goes, these catechins to the our alkaline nature of the intestine, it's degrade rapidly. Only 2% it absorbs in our body. That means 10 milligram of the catechins uptake is the 2% only goes for the absorption. So question mark comes, we are getting the pleasure or we are getting the really benefit out of these catechins. That's what we need to think. What is the other way looking into that? We can go for the nanosize particles. Even we may increase to 100 milligram of the polyphenols because bitterness can be little bit reduced, so we can increase the bioavailability. That's what we need to think. Nanotechnology may help. So we can use different techniques like electro spraying, electro spinning, spray freeze drying, nanospray. These are the techniques can be used. But one problem in here is, till date, throughout the globe, we don't have the larger scale production of the nano materials, production of the equipments or technologies. Still all are lab scale. So we need to scale up this one. How to do that? If you wanted to scale up the tons and tons of the production, that means how to handle its safety issues. But other way around, if you look at that nano emulsions, liposomes, phospholipids are widely used most of the delivery systems because of the bilayer theory. We can go for the easily both water soluble and fat soluble molecule easily deliver through that, solid lipid nanoparticles, co-acceleration. These are the techniques still existed, less safety issues. So we can go for that. But again, when it moves to the your systemic circulation, that changes the nature itself. The size of the nanoemulsion can change in the stomach, stomach to intestine and the large intestine. And look at the 3D food printer. IFPT has worked on this, and we have brought the first scientific paper and more than 10 papers published on that. Even not only we are developing the technologies, and also we are looking to develop the machine itself. This 3D printer has been developed here, and we made like a egg can be a printable, what you can see that down, probiotic has been printed, and chicken does not have that fiber. Can we add the fiber and protein from the butter mushroom can be printable form? That's what we created. A chocolate has been printable, and I said earlier, vegetables wastage is more than 20%. Can we use these vegetables making the 3D printable noodles? So kids may like to that vegetable. They not take the directly. You can make it a printable noodles. And one of the leading market in the Western countries, vegetable noodles. Anyone wanted to do the business? Again, this is the one other alternative we can think about it. Not only 3D different we can go for the other technique like extrusion techniques or whatever the existing method we can go, and we can go for the 4D printing as well. Already we have done a lot of work on the 4D printing. What is that 4D printing? It's nothing but like a pasta will be the sheet shape. Once you put it that into the hot water or the hot milk, it's twist itself during that. The shape change with respect to the time and what is that conditions you are giving, either pH or the temperature, what is the trigger mechanism, according to that it changes. Even color changes. If you put it into something on that, white color will change, the yellow color, whatever it is. That's what called a 4D printing. IFPT already working on it. And non-thermal processing techniques, this is the important, I said earlier, we need to move on from the thermal techniques. One is the high pressure processing and supercritical processing, and CFTR 25 years back itself, they started working on the supercritical fluid extraction, and high pressure processing is there in CFTRA and other IIT Kharagpur, and ozone processing and pulse electric field, ultrasound, cold plasma. IFPT has the exclusive system for both solid and liquid system, and we have the very good knowledge base and irradiation that very soon we are going to inaugurate next month Center of Excellence in the non-thermal at IFPT. All this equipment will be housed at Center of Excellence in non-thermal processing. Till now we have seen the technologies and the product for the final finished product, but we need to understand what is happening from our mouth to the stomach and intestine. This is the what the dynamics we need to know. One is the oral processing. What is happening? What is the role of teeth? Each bite, how it does with the molecules. Can molecule decide themselves where to reach, when to reach? That is the what we need to play around the designer product and bioaccessibility. What is the amount of the molecule available for the absorption in the stomach and the bioavailability? This need to be worked out, and it is possible to do that with the controlled system is available. We can do that, and this is the existing systems available throughout the globe, stomach and intestinal models. And when I started working this work at CFTRA Mysore during the 2008-9, I developed some of the nanoparticle. I wanted to study the absorption pattern of this nanomatrix as well as other food ingredients. That time we don't have the system to study the control system. We have to go for only human trials, but nanomaterial we can't directly use into the human trials. That time I was looking into that, the TNO system in the Netherlands is the only system as the approved by FDA with the stomach. This is the top portion. What is shown in here is the stomach. These are the intestine. And other system like Norwich, they have the conical type of the stomach, and Chen developed the like a pressure creation of the stomach. And then our Paul Singh sir has developed such a systems. So I wanted to develop, can we do similar type of system for our country? That 2010, I started this journey at CFTRA. And this is the what has happened when we scanned the human volunteers in the MRI scan, because you would have seen other system like a tubular systems or conical system. We wanted to go for the close to the human systems. So we scanned the MRI image of the human stomach, but we'll get only 2D image. So what we put the 2D image each stack, and then we recreated the stomach in the 3D CAD diagram like this, and then we 3D printed the stomach. I think this is the first stomach as 3D printed, and we molded the stomach. This is the stomach has been silicon rubber has been used to mold, and this is the what happening in our body during the digestion, and this is the contraction takes place from the stomach, and the wave forms here, and to every second the contraction moves, and then here air gap is there, that air pushes our meal down. And once like theories are different theories are there. One is that if a particle size is less than 2 mm size, your pyrolicule opens, then it goes out to your intestine. That's called emptying of stomach. That is the key element to decide absorption as well as your availability. And second one is that total energy or pressure has made the stomach vent to open. So we try to go very close to the what is our human condition. So we created that ARK dynamic stomach system here. It creates exactly the same temperature of the human body, the same contraction, everything. And we published recently this paper, and I made it the We are not filed any patent on this. We made it each component is available for anyone to replicate. So we published all the data. And GI glycemic index studies, we have the well-known method is one is Anglis method and another one is the Goniatart. We wanted to improve that method because that is the step is very too long. Can we use the same engineered stomach model to predict the GI model? If you look at this is the in vivo method. What is that dot line? It's a human glycemic response. And the dark line is that engineered model of GA. So we could able to predict because most of the in vitro method after 60 minutes, it comes the continuously constant. So if you look at, but human digestion system is never goes like that. GA, the glycemic load will come down. We try to get it the similar one. We inbuilt our own mathematical model. We'll put it into the mass transfer effort in the villi, what is happening in the mass transport and the, that model we inbuilt in the existing system to create almost is equivalent to the engineer's model. We have tried with the Apple and other things, human volunteers. This work has been done with IFPT with the help of Trichy Medical College, a team in the Trichy Medical College continuously supporting us to validate whatever the work is going here has been validated with the human trials with the ethical clearance. And this is the system is available. Anyone can use it to study glycemic response, disintegration kinetics. That is the important. How your particle is disintegrate in the stomach system. What is the rate of disintegration when it is releasing and the absorption pattern. So both has been done and each and every component already we have published it. Third point is the waste utilizations. And if you look at, I said earlier, the globe, one third of the product is wasted. And people may say India is wasting. No. If you look at the scenario, like a few 67 billion tons of the food is wasted every year. And India estimates 2012 data, 1 lakh crore worth of the food is wasted. But our wastage is not takes place on plate. It takes place from the farm gate to the transport to the storage. If you look at what is our conditions, once the food grains come out from the most of the farm gates and center procurement, we have to procure, we have to pay the minimum support price from the most of the states and the FCI or central warehouse, they buy the grains, especially for the wheat and rice. But the moisture content, what's supposed to be there, minimum 14% moisture, this grain should be stored. But what is happening in our storage goods? It's not happening exactly that. So wastage happens there in the rice or wheat. If you look at, we produce the 100 million tons of the rice. If wastage is 10%, we every year last 1990 to know how much amount of we increase the per hectare production rate. Production rate and production yield is almost same. Marginally 1 or 2 million tons we are able to increase per year. But our area is almost same. So how to manage this one? One way is look into that, reduce the wastage in the our post or wastage. That's what we need, a lot of technologies and utilization of the matrix. In such case, we worked with the PepsiCo UK. This is the UK R&D company. And Siddha Starch, this is the company supplies to the potatoes to the Pepsi to make a less chips. But huge amount of the peel is wasted because the peel is removed, then only slice has been made, the made the chips. So they approached the IFPT, can we join hand with the PepsiCo and Nottingham University? We worked together, this project is went on the 2 years. Finally, what we did, we made the starch out from the peel. We replaced the Crisps chips, already there, the Crisps chips is in the market. 50% we replaced with the starch. Now, this market study is already has been done that PepsiCo is very soon they're going to release this product into the market. Not only that, we developed the same type of matrix with the other product. We created the idli, chapati and other things from the wastage. We used the pulse mill, pomegranate waste and oats and the grape waste. We have taken the bioactive compounds, we added into that, we created such products from the waste itself. That's what I said, waste minimization, waste utilization, because we get huge amount of that. But one more thing, the total domestic waste in the food, if you look at the corporations, municipality, huge amount of waste is created, but we need to segregate this one. We can use it for the our purpose. Another one is the onion mission program. When we started this one in 2017, and onion, the small onion, that sellet onion, that small onion, wastage is happening continuously in that because rate is not getting adequate rate, they're going to throw it. that was happened in the 2016 late when after I took over as the director here. And the problem is that the storage structure, what they are doing, they used to call in Tamil as the patti, they'll put it in the floor. It's a Karnataka also, the almost similar type of the storage. 10% of the wastage is, takes place there. So we need a, one is the proper storage structure, stack type of structure has been created by us. And apart from that, can we give the value addition for this onion? What we did, we removed the onion skin outside that, and can we supply to the larger market like a Chennai and Bangalore? We created, and we created that incubation center at Settikulam village, Perambulu, and farmers can bring the raw material onion, they can process it, especially for the stem and root cutting, and they can make it. And this has got a lot of award, including the Vice President Award of SAGI Initiative Award for the development of the village, because this is the what waste minimization, and when the surplus production, they can use that material. And we have done, and you can see that this is the total integration unit has been developed. That onion, if you add it, that it will cut the root and stem, it goes peeling, and we can add the value added product. Once onion is peeled, the shelf life is very, very less. So what we did, we put the vacuum packing technology, then they can stay in the refrigerated condition for the more than 70 days. And our honorable secretary ma'am visited to that unit. Finally, we wanted to put it the similar kind of model throughout the country. That's what under PMFMI scheme, exclusive incubation center has been included, and already Ministry of Food Processing Industry has cleared 54 incubation centers throughout the country. Very soon, we are going to put each district one incubation center, the similar model. This is the whole unit as operated by third party, and farmers can pay whatever the user charges. They can use the facilities. They can do that. The similar model has been operated. And we found a lot of wastage is generated in this unit itself. Can we use this wastage from the some bioactive compounds? We surprised to know that flour, what has come from this onion flour, it has the good amount of the protein, and we have the prebiotics. So that's what we worked on, the wastage. From that, we made the fiber-rich biscuits and pasta and noodles, and the even film. We made the film out of the packaging, film out of the onion waste, what is generated from that unit itself. So farmers will get both the way benefit, that value addition, what that wastage is generated, and apart from that, onion itself. And what I initially mentioned about what is happening and our storage godowns, can we do some work on that? That's what we are worked with the Bernal University, Inquiring Mind, and Food Corporation of India. We wanted to monitor that sense temperature in the storage godowns. Can we do some control system? So what we develop our own monitoring system, and that is CEDAC Kolkata and Samir Mumbai, we developed own system. When the stack is coming to the storage godowns, it can be monitored the moisture. If moisture is 14%, it directly goes to the another line. There we develop the radio frequency dryer. It reduces the moisture to the ideal level 14%. Radio frequency dryer can help two way, reduce the moisture. Along with that, it kills the insect as well. So we developed that system. Already we installed that system in the Raipur Food Corporation of India storage godown. Last 1 year, it's working very well. And FCI is monitoring that system closely. If it is successful, already they are telling the report is good. And that can be going to be implemented throughout the country. So what is happening in that procurement station is, if farmers are bringing the moisture is close to the 25%, we can't take it. It has to go through that route. Anyhow, they will get what is the price they're supposed to get the price. But it a lot when entering into the storage godown, it has to be treated. But after the storing in the stack, what is going on to that? That's what we developed the sensors. It's shown here. The sensor, if you plug into the any of the storage godowns, it gives the moisture and temperature profile the signal. And we developed along with the Inquiring Mind, one of the leading sensor development in the UK company, and along with the Bernal University, we developed the sensors. These sensors will give the signals to the AgriHub. AgriHub is situated, that is the, like a IoT based network. It is there in this IFPT. The signal we can receive here, and it goes to back to your mobile. Your mobile, what it's shown here in the screen, that mobile itself, you can easily monitor what is happening in your storage godown. If temperature is goes 14, moisture is going 14%, automatically it gives the alarm. Right now, we installed more than 100 sensors in the Tamil Nadu, Punjab, as well as Guwahati, Assam. So we are monitoring how it works. The cost of the sensor is 3,500 rupees. Very soon, we are going to release this technology. So this will help to monitor our storage godowns. Not only that, the data, because the Agri Hub will be there at IFPT, can generate the data throughout the years, 365 days, 24 hours, what is happening in our storage grounds, where we have to put the concentration, all these things we can be done. So this is the area one can think about developing the futuristic sensors that can help. And the food packaging and the fourth point, you talked a lot about it, and even government is given already, we wanted to go for the alternative to single-use plastics. One is such plastic is the edible film, like a milk proteins can be used as the edible films. You can put it on the bread, can be stored, and we can eat the protein as well. Because the film, like if you go for the milk proteins, we'll get the alpha-lactalbumin, beta-lactoglobulin, that has the additional protein supplements than the inside the product. And also we develop some of the films at IFPT. This is the corn-based biopolymers we develop. We use the corn starch along with the cotton to increase the strength. So we can do that picture. You can see that that is the extruder film. Even industry scale, you can extrude that film to make it. It's a cost is 35 lakhs. You can install that units, can produce the film that can store for the bakery products, chips and other things. But we, the strength is still is not a barrier property. Some extent is fine, but strength is a bit low and the printability is low. So that already we are improving it. We try to use the nano composite like MMT and clay model, but still long way to go. But a base film can be used from here. And other things as we use the jackfruit, if you take it, only we are using the 35% of the jackfruit. And you would have seen the recently a lot of messages going around the jackfruit as the low GI product. Yes, unripened jackfruit can give the low GI because the fiber is rich in that product. Can we use this jackfruit waste? Whatever we use, 70% is waste. That's what we created the plate from the jackfruit. After eating your product or food, you can eat plate as well. Your plate may be having the highest nutrition than the what you are taking on the plate. An edible cookie and coffee cups has been developed, can be after drinking the coffee like a cones, you can eat cup as well. And this is what I said about nano packaging things, because these are virgin films, barrier property directly it goes. If you add the nano composites, increase the tetanus pathway, that means increase the strength. Is you can see that that nano pack on company has released a film, extended the fruits at 40% higher shelf life. That's because of this nano composites, because strength is increasing, and apart from that, barrier property also increasing. Another one technology has been developed at IFPT is that carton box. When the potato is transported, the main problem is spouting. You can see that how quickly it comes from the longer transport it is because of that conditions and the respiration is happened. So what we did, we tried to alter the transport mechanisms itself. So we made that carton box, we made the hole on it, and we put the inside the coating, and the coating has the clove oil and other CMC and other things that give the antimicrobial activity onto that. And recently we signed the MOU with the World Code and one of the largest supply chain market in India. They are already implemented this technology and they said it's working very well. So we wanted to expand into the other commodities. Is it possible to change the existing? Because existing, they have the cotton box. They can't change into another one. So we wanted to use the same existing method, slight change using the technological input. Food safety and supply chain management, another area we need to concentrate, because urbanization is increases the more concentration on the problem of food safety issues, and the traceability is the big concern for us. If you see that government already thinking to go for the taxation of higher salt, sugar and fat. Some of the countries already has made this is the mandatory to reduce the salt, sugar and fat. But what is the alternative in front of us? How to change or add the new sugar into the our molecules, or what is the matrix, the cost, what will happen? So this is what we need to work. And we have done some studies on the nano salt and electrospray nano salt is a 30% less perception. When it goes to the tongue, it solubilizes faster. Then your brain sensitizes, yes, is the more salt is coming. That what this only surface level. But solubility of the matrix, if you add it into the another product, we need a different technology. Now, people are using combination of the potassium with the sodium salt. Can be, but still, we have to work a lot into that. But again, fat alternatives, what are the other alternatives for the fat molecules and the sugar? One is the ideal is sugar is the, I said earlier, for the coconut sugar or nira sugar can be used. Vietnam is totally using on that. But our sugar in our country, what produced from our coconut trees, the GI is still higher, close by the our canned sugar, what is coming there, like a GI is almost 75 to 80. This is coming around 65. That's what we are unable to market it, our cane sugar or the brown sugar into the Western market. So we try to bring the level of GI low. Then anyhow, minerals and other things are there, so easily we can marketable. And blockchain technology, see, whatever it comes to my plate, can I know the farmer? Is it possible? One QR code attached with any product, just I'll scan who prepared, who harvested, who is the farmer name, which district, which village he harvested, what is the time of harvest, when he has taken out, who has purchased from the traders, when it is moved. Each and everything can I know from our mobile when I scan the QR code. Yes, it's possible. Already US has been implemented very well on this blockchain management. India, we need to adapt quickly. But it's expensive, but it's doable. But industry has to come forward to adapt these technologies to use from the each and every stage has to be entered into the blockchain. It is available for consumer to understand. If something goes wrong in the storage, something goes wrong, the transport is important. Till date, India, we are unable to do any callback. Something happened in the final product, how to call back that one? And to whom we will punish? Where is the problem went on? We don't know. So for that purpose, this traceability purpose, the spoilage, this one, monitoring the whole systems, we need like this. Like already we have implemented like a fast track and other things, how we are able to monitor each and every movements. Why not? We can't do that for the our food. When it's produced from any farm gate, when reaching to any person, can we trace? If you're able to trace, really, we can reach out to the level. Yes, we can reduce the minimizing the wastage, because we know that where is the wastage is happening, how to utilize this wastage into other places. That's what this blockchain mechanism definitely will help to move on to that direction. And application of CFD and artificial intelligence and IoT is the another areas. And computational modeling has been a revolution, actually. But you need to understand, this is a pure science. It is not like we are making the model and the sitting in the system develop such one. So for example, this is the one thing is a large, that beer, if you make the beer, it has to be pasteurized. And how it moves inside the beer tunnel pasteurization, it is difficult to put it each and every place, sensors to monitor how it is happening. So we can do one thing is, we can make it a geometry and you create the mesh. Finally, we can calculate the what is the temperature and all. So what we have done, we made this system and you can see that we put that what we predicted, the temperature of the bottle inside. This is the what we measured, what we predicted in the computer. It's matched exactly same. It reduces the cost and time and energy. So we need to see that. And even PU value can do that. If you know that how inactivation is taking place in the Saccharomyces cerevisiae, it's possible. If you use the first order kinetics of Arginius, we can able to do that. We can predict that also. So output value easily possible to get it from the computational modeling. But we need to understand the what is the Navier-Stokes equation of mass, momentum, energy. A food scientist, food engineers can able to put it in together. Any food system can be able to predict the level what we have shown in this slide. And artificial intelligence is the another area. We need to adapt food system, but other industry is well adapted. For example, deep learning or the big data analysis. And big data analysis is the key element now for the market, and which is the product is going and the online trading is increased more than 150 times in India. But that gives the data analysis, which segment, which is the product has taken in the which state, and which, you know, one thing remaining, like local product is dominating now because people wanted to buy from the local brand. So they wanted to see that they believe it, the local products makes a good product. That's what this big data analysis from the online marketing, we have that all this data and internet of thinking and that. AI and ANN can be used for the our food industry. One more thing is the 3D visual stores. This is again operate based on the AI techniques, and IFPT has created the food innovation centers in line with the Monash University Innovation Centers. Because now the most of the product sold in Indian market, especially in the metros, in the supermarket, when you enter in the supermarket, where your eyeball is going, can we able to track and then get the data analysis from that? If myself, my son and my daughter will enter into the any stores, I look some product and my son will look something, my daughter height and the color combinations, I like blue color, maybe he likes green. So how it is going to that? So which is the segment you wanted to target and where to place your product? Everything can be mapped. This is the virtual store can be created, because first you have to go to that store. You have to take that video that can be created virtually in the IRPT. We have the system and we have the computational modeling to predict that on your eyeball tracking. So that will give the clarity on that, how you can map your product and where you wanted to keep your product shelves and which is the color and what is the logo. What is the shape of your bottle or pet bottle? Everything can be done from 3D visual stores. For me, these are the technologies going to be a feature for the Indian food processing industry. One is the waste utilization, IoT based technologies. Already we have done the low carbon footprint. And if you look at whatever comes from our plate, 1/3 of the product has been transmitted from more than 1,000 kilometers. How much amount of the carbon footprint, the cost in it? So we wanted to reduce that on. So that type of technologies definitely will dominate. Hypershore processing, frozen technologies definitely has the edge. And we have discussed about vacuum frying and freeze drying, salt and sugar alternative technology. These are technologies will definitely has the edge in the future. And these are the product in the backdrop of COVID may be dominant in the future, not only for Indian market and the export market based on these are the source from the IFT and other things. One is that clean product, organic, fresh, non-GMO, immune boosters. These are the product, the labeling and proven values are there. Definitely that product is going to dominate. And product with the specific like antioxidant, omega-3 fatty acids, vitamins, minerals, all these products, another place is there, and plant-based diets and exotic foods and as well as the insects foods. Insects also can be used as a supplement. It has the good amount of the proteins, and some other countries they're using. So we can think about that, how to use anything. Our food systems, our dream is to make India as the world food factory, because throughout the globe they wanted to take India's products, because we are world number one in the most of the commodities, fruits and vegetables, everything, even milk, we reached already world number one. And if you look at the fruits and vegetable, we are world number two, almost 300 million tons of the fruits and vegetable we produce. But we need to make sure this has to be reached throughout the globe as the form of value-added product. That only food processing sector can do that, then we can rule whole world. In this thing, whole everybody should be part of that. Research institutions, industries, farmers, traders, all has to be joined together to make that big dream to come true. That for me, whatever we have, $263 billion market is going to be $535 billion market soon. In that scenario, it's going to be happen very soon. Once again, thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, sir. It was a very informative as well as energetic lecture covering all the aspects, like what to be upgraded in the technological side, what is the future, and what should be done for the sustainable development of our food processing sector. Participants, if you have any doubts or any doubts to be cleared, please put it in the chat box. Sir will be answering that. Quickly, you can please type it in the chat box, then we will move on to the next session. One question is there. Sir, are you taking research interns?
Yeah, we are taking the research interns. Please visit to IFPT website and as well as the our social media. We are regularly taking. And sensors recording, yes, we are developing the biosensors, nano sensors for monitoring the spoilage, the food products. It is the only way we can look, we can develop the biosensors, and its accuracy is very high because we need to, traceability is a big concern. So that is the one area people can work, and a lot of sensors already available in the market. CFD can be evolved, is like almost is a 10 years people are trying to use CFD, but issue is that food engineers and food technologists, because CFD in other system like aerospace industry and combustion industry is widely used. Without that, we can't do anything. But when it comes to food industry issue is we need to understand one side the full engineering principles to use this flow behaviors. Another things we need to understand the matrix of the protein, all these things. So that means a food technologist, food engineers can you use the CFD well, but more people has to come forward to use it. Yeah, nutrition students, yes, you can pursue in the future of food technology. CFTRI is the MSc food technology. If you are a basic degree in the nutrition, you can apply and you can have the admission in CFTRI. And other institutions also now offering with the basic degree of the nutrition, they can pursue that because we need a now nutraceutical market is the growing market. Indian nutraceutical market is around now 16% compared to world market is 8%. Now we are thinking we wanted to rule the whole world in the nutraceutical market. That's what that prediction is going on. That means you have the very good scope onto that in the nutraceutical market and food ingredients market. Yeah, we can use that proteins, pea proteins, all these things. That's what even better than we can go for the even our own proteins because they are coming from outside countries. Why we have to spend time and energy to extract the proteins from whatever is comes from the imported things? We can do that. Startups, yes, this is the one concern still. India, if you look at a total registered startup in the Commerce Ministry and other things, we have more than 15,000 startups are registered. And out of that, how many food startups is very less because startups fails in the food system because after 3 years, they are nowhere. Very few startups. I mentioned about Beyond Meat or Redefined Meat. It's very few startups are picking up. The problem is your idea can't sellable. You can't sell your idea. You need to know how to market your idea. That has to be understand. You need to go to the market. You need to understand the market, what people wanted. So people are thinking, yes, I have the idea. I can create some product. It goes to market. No. First, you create your product, give to your home. Five people, at least three people has to accept your product. Then you move on to your state, district. Then you go for the state. This is the way you can go for the marketing the product. Straight away, they wanted to create the product. They wanted to put it into the foreign market. They have to understand the flavor, what is they accept. That even color of the packaging, that's what startup has to be understand. And government of India has brought a lot of support for the startups and most of the institution has the incubation center. You can incubate your company, we'll support, technological support, all these things. Quickly, last question. Yeah, not much difference from UK and India. If you look at the food processing industry throughout the globe, it is almost same. Now we reach the level is a certification is what I said, the rainforest certificate, the US, all the certification is can be get it from the India itself. That means that third party certification, international agency is giving bits. They have to follow all the whatever the prerequisites to your need to run the, your company. That means almost it's the same. We are not able to see any difference from the technology wise. We are very good technology. If you compare to any other industry, food industry, we evolved the good technologies for Indian origin product. So that's not the big thing. And incubation center, yes, Gujarat already we have given some of the incubation centers and we are going to give each district and all the states, we are going to give an incubation center. If you are from the, any of the institutions, please visit to IFPT or Ministry of Food Processing website. We given the PMFME site. You can apply that incubation portal and we are planning to give. Once again, thank you so much. And I'm eagerly welcome for our director, CFTRI ma'am, to give a lecture. Thank you so much for listening my talk.
Thank you, sir. Now our minister, madam. Sir, I would like to give a brief introduction about ma'am. Dr. Sridevi, an accomplished food technologist and active researcher, has taken over as director of CSIR CFTRI in January 2021. And in a career spanning over three decades, she worked extensively on both basic and applied aspects of food science, and significant contributions were made by madam towards unfolding protein structure, function, activity relationships, relationships on proteins and enzymes as food ingredients, Nutraceuticals from Traditional Food and Technologies for Combating Malnutrition. And Madam has published over 50 manuscripts in peer-reviewed journals and holds 11 patents to her credit, including 5 US patents. And ma'am will be speaking on food processing opportunities for women entrepreneurs. Welcome you, ma'am.
Madam has come. Yeah, 1 minute. I think Minister ma'am has joined. Sorry, ma'am. Just now we got the message. Welcome, ma'am.
Namaskar.
Welcome, ma'am. The most respected chief guest, Srimati Smriti Irani Madam, Honorable Union Minister of Women and Child Development, Government of India, respected Director, Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, Ministry of Food Processing Industries, Dr. C. Ananth Ramakrishnan, sir, Mrs. Chaya Nanjappa, ma'am, Country President, India, and State President, Karnataka, for Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry, Mr. Parul Soni, Secretary General, Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry, Ms. IFG Megbo, ADWCI Country President Nigeria, distinguished guests and speakers for technical session, ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant evening to all. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you all for this online workshop on empowerment and opportunities for global women entrepreneurs in food sector, jointly organizing by Association of Women in Commerce and Industry and Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology. Now let us begin the inaugural session by virtual lamp lighting ceremony. Mrs. Chaya Nanjappa Madam, Country President India and State President Karnataka for Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry, an award-winning first-generation rural women entrepreneur and the founder and managing partner of the brand Nectar Fresh, which is a khadi and village bought-backed rural enterprise that has been empowering the rural and tribal folk as well as the small farmers. Initiated as a small startup, presently, the unit is producing 400 tons of products every month. And Madam is also IIFPT's Executive Council member. And I would like to invite Madam for the welcome address. Ma'am, please.
Namaste, everyone. On behalf of ABWCI, I would like to warmly welcome each one of you for being here with us today. I welcome you all to this webinar on empowerment and opportunities for global women entrepreneurs in the food sector. It is jointly organized by ABWCI and the Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, Ministry of Food Processing Industries, Government of India. This August gathering will also witness a milestone event of a MOU signing between IIFPT and ABWCI. Before we get started, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to all of you who generously helped us make this event come together to become a success. It fills me with immense pride to inform you that Srimati Smriti Irani Ji, Honorable Minister for Women and Child Development, has kindly agreed to grace the occasion and would be sharing a perspective and thought with all of us. My heartfelt thanks to Srimati Smriti Irani Ji for for accepting our invitation and consenting to be among us today in spite of our extremely busy schedule. There can't be a more befitting dignitary than Smriti ji to preside over this event, for the vision of ABWCI is to empower women entrepreneurs and promote them as ambassadors for sustainable development. Undoubtedly, Smriti ji is one who's instrumental in steering India as a women-friendly nation. I welcome you to this important program today, madam. You have honored us by your presence. I'm particularly happy to witness the signing of this MOU with the Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, which is an extended family to me. I'm extremely happy to welcome Dr. Anant Ramakrishnan, Director IIFPT, to this MOU signing ceremony and the workshop. I cherish my first ever visit to IIFPT to be part of their esteemed executive committee after Dr. Anant Ramakrishnan assumed charge as the director of IIFPT. All thanks to Dr. Anant Ramakrishnan and his vibrant team today, which has taken a leap, has been considered as the institute of national importance last month. They amaze me with their continuous innovations and achievements. And it is never a surprise to me. He's always been a doer and has strived to raise the benchmark of this organization in every opportunity. I'm delighted that you are here to sign the MOU with ABWCI today. And I'm certain that together we could take the partnership between IIFPT and ABWCI to a new dimension. Partnership and harmony are always the key words towards reforms and excellence. We look forward to being able to utilize the knowledge and expertise of Team IIFPT to achieve the goals of ABWCI. So, once again, I warmly welcome you to this event. We are also proud to co-host an interactive session on empowerment and opportunities for global women entrepreneurs in the food sector later this evening, in partnership with IIFPT. In today's webinar, we would focus on the tremendous potential and opportunity that the food sector presents to women entrepreneurs. During the specially curated technical session today, you will be getting an exclusive opportunity to learn from the industry stalwarts, from food and hospitality sector giants, ITC and Marriott, along with the guidance from the pride R&D institutions of Bharat, CFTRI and IIFPT. Together, they will help you explore these opportunities to connect globally and develop your own business strategies and growth plans. I'm sure that the session will help you grow to be more productive. I extend a warm welcome to all the distinguished speakers for today's important webinar. Dr. Maheshwar Sir, former Vice Chancellor, University of Horticulture Sciences, Bagalkot. Sir, extremely grateful that you took time to be with us in spite of my last minute call. My very special thanks to Madam Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Director CSIR CFTRI, country's pride R&D institute, situated at Namma Mysuru, for being with us today and agreeing to share a vast knowledge and expertise on the food sector. Respected Madam, knowing your very busy schedule, we thank you wholeheartedly for accepting our invitation and being here with us. We feel extremely proud that a lady is currently heading the Premier R&D Institute and a Pride CFTRI. My special thanks to Mr. Baranidharan Ramaswamy Ji, Director of Procurement Marriott Hotels, for cancelling his prior appointments to be in our webinar today to guide and inspire women entrepreneurs. I'm a vendor with Marriott and personally know how Barani ji walks his talk. He has been instrumental in my association with another international women's organization. I also want to specially thank Mr. Girish Mohanty, the Operational Manager, Corporate Social Investments, ITC Limited, ITC is one organization that has always backed women's empowerment within a short notice. All of them consented to be part of this important day. I thank you all for taking out your valuable time and honoring my invitation with your esteemed presence. I'm also extremely grateful to Dr. Chidanand, Assistant Professor IIFPT, for having done all the needful to lead this event towards a grand success, and team IIFPT for their perfect coordination. Dr. Chidanand has always been an able coordinator who brings plans into reality. My very special thanks to Dr. Srinija, who for sparing her time and helping us make this event a success. Dhanyavad, ma'am. From a humble homemaker to an experienced entrepreneur and founder of the brand Nectarfish, my journey has been all about converting challenges into opportunities. And today, I stand before you all as a country president of ABWCI, an organization that connects women globally to the world of opportunities. As a first generation rural entrepreneur, I have tried hard through many challenges to reach here, and am today. Now, it is with great pride I see that I empower my fellow rural and tribal women to come forward and achieve as entrepreneurs. I promote women entrepreneurship in various national and international forums. So all that is required is a spark and a hand-holding support that could foster a conducive environment for women in business. And these are indeed the vision and mission of ABWCI. Economic empowerment of women in business is not just an individual or organizational goal. It is the ultimatum for the progress of any country. Food sector is a sunrise sector with immense opportunities and avenues for development. It is the right guidance that would lead a woman entrepreneur in the food processing sector to confidently walk her path towards success. And I'm certain that today's workshop and the eminent speakers would enlighten aspiring women entrepreneurs with that guiding light. With that note, I once again welcome you all to this webinar and wishing you a fruitful time attending this event. Dhanyavad. Namaste.
Thank you, madam, for your warm welcome. Proceeding to the next presidential address, I would like to invite Dr. C. Anandaramakrishnan, sir, Director, Indian Institute of Food Processing Technology, Thanjavur, under whose leadership IIFPT has won several laurels in the last 5 years, and also recently IIFPT has achieved the Institute of National Importance Standards. Sir has won several laurels, including the fellows of various professional bodies, as well as he published his research endeavors of more than 2 decades in more than 150 impact factor publications, patents, as well as books and book chapters. May I now invite Dr. C. Anandaramakrishnan, sir, for the presidential address. Sir, please.
Most respected, our Honorable Minister, Srimati Smriti Irani, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am, accepting our invitation. You are the ideal choice for such type of event, and one of the dynamic member of ministerial state. And thank you so much, ma'am. And really, if you look at Indian food processing sector is doing wonderful. Last almost 7 years, we are achieving almost 10% growth rate. And one sector, if you look at, not shown any negative growth in contributing much into the our Indian economy. And not only that, almost 19% of the workforce in the Indian food processing sector. And it larger industry, if you look at, more employable sector is coming from the Indian food processing sector. Empowering women, what Chaya ma'am itself is the one of the example, started 2009, is the with the only 10 lakhs rupees, the unit now catering to the more than 100 employable people in the direct and indirect, and reaching almost all the bigger hotels. So that is the what women, when started doing the business, they understand the consumers. They know how consumer preference, how they make, because we know this mother's taste and our grandma's taste. They understand well about what is the consumers or kids needs. So that's what this woman empowerment, when we are talking, we have to think only a food processing sector. I'll give one more example, ma'am. one Manjula, she was the tailoring, she was doing only tailoring jobs. She got only 10,000 rupees per month, and she came to IFPT for things, and we suggested to go for PMKVY training, and she underwent 28 days of PMKVY training. After that, she brought the raw material, used IFPT incubation center. She produced the millet biscuit and sold in the local market. Then later, she started her own industry with the support of Government of India and IFPT support. 35 lakhs, she started the units, and now she started second unit for making the millet noodles and pasta. Right now, her product is reached Dubai and Singapore. Now she's earning per month 3 lakh rupees. Not only that, more than 20 women employed in her unit. This is the success of this sector. This sector can yield more local employment, and 20 women getting the employable in the small village of Vallam village. So that is the what Government of India decided. If you look at the whole Indian food processing sector, 90% of the units are coming in the micro food processing units. So Ministry of Food Processing Industry decided to launch Prime Minister formalization of micro food processing scheme for last year. 1 year is over already. FAO United Nations is thinking this is the best model. Already they are asking how this model is working. We were able to see already the fruits of this model. Whoever got benefited under PMFME scheme, farmers are getting benefited, individual entrepreneurs are getting benefited. Just 3 lakhs rupees you are to invest, 17 lakhs loan will be arranged by Government of India, 10 lakhs subsidy will be provided under PMFME schemes. And not only that, you no need to go anywhere else. Just you put the application, the people, DRP, that is called a consultant, come to you, arrange the loan, subsidy, technical support will be provided by all the national institutions, and you can start your unit. This is the unique model is operated by our country, the bottom-up approach. The within a 1 year time, we could see that a lot of people are getting benefited in the country. All the 700 district, we mapped one district, one product, unique product as mapped by the Government of India. The scheme, definitely after 4 years, what our target is, 8 lakh people should be trained, and 2 lakh entrepreneurs has to come. I said about one small unit, 20 employable people have got benefited. So more women will come forward to use these units, then we can create a lot of employable people, and also our product can reach even foreign. And not only that, our export market last 1 year, that COVID time, all the industry struggled. And if you look at Indian food processing sector, it's gone beyond the reach. More than 20% our increase the export market, 35% increase in the ready-to-cook product. So in this scenario, Government of India launched another scheme of PLI scheme to support export market. Definitely the combination of PMFME and as well as PLI to help our Indian food processing industry to go forward. And this type of conference and workshop will help our Indian women sector people to start working on thinking to put investment in the food processing sector to grow ourselves, as well as the support from each and everyone to make profitable unit in this sector. Thank you so much, ma'am. Especially our Honorable Minister, ma'am, accepting our invitation, being with us is really, it's we are thrilled, and we wanted to listen your talk, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. May now invite Mr. Parul Soni, sir, Secretary General, Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry, and also the founder and global managing partner of Think Through Consultancy, with over 25 years of national and international experience and expertise in the international investment. So, sir will be Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry. Welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Good evening to everyone, and I welcome our Cabinet Minister, Honorable Minister for Women and Child Development, Smriti Irani ji. Thank you, ma'am, for blessing this occasion today, and I feel honored on behalf of ABWCI, because ABWCI has started from the Global South, which has started from the South Asia and has now reached 15 countries. We are a global organization of women entrepreneurs and working with women leaders worldwide. The thinking has been that, you know, how can we work together with corporates, with government, with social organizations, with institutes, education institutions, incubators, accelerators, and all the stakeholders which can help women entrepreneurs to achieve the potential. That was the entire thinking. I also want to thank all the directors today who are present, and also want to thank that in this kind of session and this kind of workshop and seminar, we with your coming, ma'am, really it will help and boost the morale, and it will inspire our women entrepreneurs to see that, you know, we can achieve the potential of global economy. That was the entire thinking of creating this. And the time has been come when, in this situation, the director spoke about, IFT director spoke about the growth in the economy with the food processing, sector. The thinking is, if more and more women come in the forefront of the global economy, we feel that, you know, we can achieve not only a global economy, you know, our prime minister's dream of $5 trillion, but also achieve globally the whole thinking that they can all deserve, that the entire perspective of wealth creation and also create employability. With these words, thank you, ma'am, for blessing this webinar. And also I want to thank everyone, our global team and our global presidents. And I want to really see that with this program in India, our African friends, our friends in Mekong and all in different countries will benefit from the institute, which is in India on food processing. And I feel more and more occasions will come when we will do more of technology transfer so that countries benefit and women entrepreneurs can start and incubate new businesses. Thank you, ma'am, for blessing this occasion. And I really am thankful for all your time and also effort, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Today, the august presence of Honorable Minister Madam, IAFPT and ABWCI is signing MOU for the technical support towards women empowerment and women entrepreneurship development. May I now request Director IAFPT, Dr. C. Anantha Ramakrishnan, sir, and Country President ABWCI, Mrs. Chaya Nanjappa, madam, to show the MOU virtually, which will be exchanged physically later. Thank you, sir, and thank you, madam. With great respect and pleasure, let me now invite today's chief guest of the event, Srimati Smriti Irani, madam, Honorable Minister of Women and Child Development in the Union Cabinet of India. Though there is no introduction is needed for madam, just let me introduce ma'am briefly. Born on 23rd March 1976, Mrs. Smriti Irani, madam, was elected to the Rajya Sabha, the upper house of the Indian Parliament, representing the state of Gujarat in the year 2011. In August 2017, madam was re-elected to Rajya Sabha from the state of Gujarat, and in 2019 general election, madam was elected to Lok Sabha from Amethi, and madam is currently the Union Minister for Women and Child Development. Smriti Irani, madam, was the Union Minister for Human Resource Development from May 2014 to July 2016, Minister for Information and Broadcasting from July 2017 to May 2018, and Minister for Textiles from July 2016 to July 2021. And madam is India's youngest Union Cabinet Minister in the government and the first woman to hold office as Union Minister for Human Resource Development and also Union Minister of Textiles. Madam has also launched Saksham, the first ever vision document released by any political organization in India, which underlines policies, programs, and implementation tools for the upliftment of the differently abled people in India. And in the 126th Assembly of the Inter-Parliamentary Union, madam was unanimously elected as a member representing the Asia-Pacific region to the task force responsible for establishing the first ever committee for young parliamentarians in the IPU. At the same assembly, madam was also unanimously elected by member nations as rapporteur for the Standing Committee on Sustainable Development, Finance and Trade. The World Economic Forum has named madam as the young global leader from India for the year 2015. So we are very much delighted and privileged to have you here today with us for this virtual workshop as the chief guest, and I cordially invite you, madam, to deliver the chief guest address. Ma'am, please.
Distinguished panelists, from the Association of Business Women in Commerce and Industry. Ladies and gentlemen, for me, it is a matter of great pride that I today join enterprising women and men who seek to support women in all walks of life to talk about empowerment and opportunities for global women entrepreneurs in food. At the onset, I would like to congratulate the association for bringing much needed focus and ensuring that a workshop takes place, which is a representation of your collaborative efforts and your desire to give wings to those details that encompass within it many a dreams. If we look at the whole universe of women who are working in the food processing sector, today the NSSO sample survey says that over 12 lakh women unregistered work in this sector. If you look at the survey, the annual survey of industries, we know that over 2 lakh female entrepreneurs are in the business of food. Speakers before me have enunciated much about government interventions, which oscillates from the PLI scheme, valued at over 10,000 crores, onwards to initiatives undertaken by the Ministry of Food Processing. I would like to hear, however, flag a few, albeit small achievements, but nonetheless, initiatives that were much needed. My compliments to my colleagues in the Ministry of Food Processing, who have now constituted a special gender budget cell, which affects change in policy and program, especially when there are gender imbalances with regards to budget and development grants. It has to be said that the Honorable Prime Minister especially wanted to ensure that there is a formalization of micro enterprises in the sector. And that is what has been complemented by the Ministry of Food Processing, for which, as a woman, they have my grateful thanks. If you look at just a snapshot of what the ministry has tried to do with regards to female entrepreneurs, there has been a creation of backward and forward linkages scheme under the ministry, wherein 6 projects which are led by female entrepreneurs have been assisted by the ministry at a cost of over 26 crores. Additionally, when we talk about women entrepreneurs, it must be said that a total of 10 cold chain projects by women entrepreneurs has been assisted to a project cost tune of over 266 crores. 7 mega food projects assisted by the ministry have female promoters. My inclination has always been that when we talk about women in enterprise, we also look at opportunities for women in that same field to turn research papers out so that more can be understood about the sector. Today, I'm happy to say that the ministry actively assists 18 female researchers in the field of food processing. Now, many presume that food and women, especially in the traditional background, the cultural context of our nation, must be complementary. And I would just throw up a few numbers that many of you are already aware of to show the disbalance. When I opened my remarks, I spoke about 12 lakh unregistered women, according to NSSO, in the sector, and 2 lakh female entrepreneurs who are recognized by the ministry as participants in the field of enterprise and food. My request to the association is this: now that we know that there are 12 lakh unregistered female workers in the sector, can we look at a formalization of this female workforce, so that they are not bereft of any social security support that is being extended by the government? I think if we are talking about empowerment and opportunities for women in the food sector, this should be our first initiative. We all know that out of all the operational factories in our country, according to annual survey of industries, over 16% of them are from the food processing business. Have we ever analyzed threadbare that data to recognize how many of those operational factories are run by women, not only as enterprises, but also women who are floor managers? if we can gather that data, I think that data will enrich us from many a perspective. From the perspective of skill, from the perspective of women who have had abject experience in the field, who can then hope to, with some capital support, turn into entrepreneurs themselves. If we can do this intervention, I think that truly your desire to create new opportunities for women as entrepreneurs in the food business can be met. We all know that between April 2014 and March 2020, in our country, the food sector attracted over $4.8 billion worth of FDI. Have we ever sat down and asked how many of those women who are now formally recognized as registered female entrepreneurs received that FDI? The numbers, I can guarantee you, are abysmal. Which means that these women who are entrepreneurs in the food sector are in need of added support so that they can invite domestic as well as international investment. Can the association create an ecosystem or an investment environment so that more and more female enterprises receive FDI support? My fourth request on this platform is this. We know that the food processing industry provides employment to 11.36% of our workforce as per the annual survey of industry. Given that I have the portfolio and the responsibility of women and child development, one of the greatest interventions to ensure that there is a safe environment at work is the prevention of sexual harassment at workplace for women, the POSH Act. My request is to the association, all the dignitaries who've joined us in this conversation today, how many of our factory floors and organizations and enterprises, as per the POSH Act, have an internal complaints committee? Because I believe that you have the power not only to create opportunities for female enterprises, but also the female workforce. And I'm hoping that the association will expand its bandwidth accordingly. If you put your might behind the need to ensure that the labor code, which provides for equal wage for equal work, and sexual harassment, the internal complaints committee are constituted in every enterprise in the food sector, I think you will contribute much to the word empowerment that is being espoused in your title today. We all know that India is one of the largest producers of milk, of bananas, mangoes, guavas, papaya, but how much of it goes waste? That has been a constant concern in the Indian economy. Which means in this concern lies an opportunity. We today talk about the female enterprise which can convert waste into an enriching experience. However, knowing Indian women, we would not even want a single morsel to go waste. We have today a force of over 7 million self-help groups in our country, which empower over 70 million women. If we have a topography scanned and surveyed wherein we know where the highest amount of wastage of fruits and other food materials is happening, can we through the association create an ecosystem in collaboration with local self-help groups so that instead of that component going waste, we find a diversified methodology of getting it into the proper channel of female enterprise, or for that matter, in factory settings. We know that food waste itself has many an opportunities with regards to investment. How many of us who are female enterprises within the sector have looked at that diversified opportunity? Let me just give you an example, not from the food sector, but from the textile sector, which I had a privilege to serve. We predominantly looked at the silk sector from the perspective of ensuring we are self-sufficient, self-reliant. But given there was a limitation with regards to farming of the silkworm, much could have been done in terms of our engagement with farmers when we asked them to look at silk waste. And the waste was such that pharmaceutical companies and companies that manufacture beauty products like L'Oreal, they started picking up that silk waste to create new verticals for farmers to exploit financially. Has that been done in the food sector? If we can give those opportunities to female enterprises, given their limitation of capital, given their limitation of technology, or for that matter, other assets that service their enterprise, maybe we give them new opportunities to actualize the financial prowess of their organizations. And lastly, I know that this forum is such that many inquiries with regards to opportunities will come to the fore. Can we also look at the expanse of the collective which is on this platform today to see which aspects of technology need to be enhanced when it comes to female enterprises? Today, if we can actualize enhancement of technology for female enterprises, we can help increase their efficacy and prospects for doing more business. I'm hopeful that my request today on this platform can be paid heed to, because in women truly lies Atmanirbhar Bharat and the future of a strong nation. My compliments to the association and all the dignitaries who've joined us today. And I'm hopeful that the 2 lakh registered female enterprises grows from strength to strength. And I'm hopeful that the 12 lakh women who are unregistered workers in the sector can find not only solace, but support in your association. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, my compliments and my best wishes.
Thank you very much, madam, for your insightful, thought-provoking, as well as very impressive address. Definitely, as you suggested, we will be addressing the issues, that 4 issues which you put forward, like the association, as well as institutes like IFPT and CFTRI, in collaboration with the ABWCI Association. We will be working out for the same, ma'am. Thank you so much for sparing your valuable time with us, ma'am. Next, may I invite Ms. Ayobji Megbob, CEO of No Leftovers Nigeria Limited, which is a full-scale catering outfit which started with the sale of local bean cakes and grown to million business now. And may I now request Madam Ayobji to deliver the formal vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Thank you. On behalf of ABWCI, IIFPT, and the entire women entrepreneur community, I would like to extend my sincere thanks to all of you. I want to say a big thank you to our chief guests, Srimati Simriti Irani, who gave her vital time from her very, very busy schedule to grace this amazing meeting. I want to thank all the speakers for sharing with us their graceful opinions. Now, to all our members, partners, and associates, I would like to say that we have all been chosen to be a part of this movement called ABWCI due to our mutual passion and purpose for establishing a collaborative ecosystem to engage, network, identify, and leverage market opportunities globally. Our passions will definitely go a long way to helping us to unite, and the energy we're able to create together is what will allow us to be inclusive and to achieve our individual as well as organizational aspirations. There is so much to be done, and I know that as we continue to put our efforts together, we will make the world a better place. Once again, I would like to state that we are glad to have all our speakers over here and to thank you for being with us. It has remained a pronounced pleasure, and I hope we all have a good evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Madam Ayobji. ADWCI Country President Nigeria for delivering this vote of thanks. So with this, we come to the end of the inaugural session of this virtual webinar. Now we will continue with the technical session. For this technical session on food processing opportunities for women entrepreneurs, may I now request the session chair, Dr. D.L. Maheshwar sir, the former Vice Chancellor, University of Horticulture Sciences, Bagalkot. Sir has done his master's degree in agriculture and a PhD degree in horticulture from University of Agricultural Sciences, Bangalore, and FRHS from United Kingdom. With a long span of 34 years of service, sir served at various positions like teacher, researcher, development consultant specializing in horticulture, and sir was responsible for the establishment of Center of Excellence for Oil Palm at Mysore, which is the first time in our country itself. Now I welcome you, sir. Now the session is over to you, sir. You may please brief about the session in few minutes, and then we can continue with the technical session, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Well, at the outset, let me congratulate and compliment the MOU which signed between ABWCA and IFPTI. The initiatives are very much applauded. Let me thank the initiation of Madam Chaya Nanjappa Rajappa for her initiative, which is ably been supported by Dr. C. Anandaramakrishnan, the director of IIFPTI. I'm very sure over a period of time, this understanding is going to bring in a greater change in the dimensions of this food industry. So far, Dr. Anandaramakrishnan has explained the historical perspectives with the scientific perspectives. So in the sense, he has touched from millets to pomegranate to onion and to jackfruit. So I'm sure that the technological interventions, what has been already developed, now that must reach down to the, you know, the real grounds. I'm also very much, you know, impressed by the way the Honorable Minister for Women and Child Development, Government of India, Madam Srimati Smriti Iraniji's concern of, you know, getting the unregistered onto the platform of registration, conducting a deeper sense of intense and extensive research on the database and relevance of this, and also as to how best the technology could be able to drive home the dependent women folk to bring in a greater change. I'm sure the panelists of this session, including Sri Devi Annapurna Singh, this director of CFTRI, Sri Bharanidharan Ramaswamy, again Anandaramakrishnan and Girish Mohan, they have their own experience, they have their own exposure in the field of food industry, wherein their insights, their visions are going to make us a better outlook for the promotion of this woman-based entrepreneurship. I'm very sure that all the listeners and the participants in this webinar, they are going to appreciate that women are the pillars of food system and they are the agents of change in bringing the food security. And more so that anything that we are going to support for the expansion of opportunities for women is also an international right and an obligation. So we have to regard that and we have to respect that. Well, it is quite true that given an opportunity to women, they can support the promotion of agriculture production to over 20%, and they can also support the lowering of the hungry-based people in the country to the extent of 20 to 30%. So for that, several, you know, plans, programs have been envisaged in a country like India. Now, looking at the future prospects of development of the women entrepreneurship in India is very bright, is quite visible, and their contributions are going to be more significant. So let us develop an ecosystem, as rightly incited by the Honorable Minister, that we'll develop an ecosystem which is going to promote the woman-based entrepreneurs, especially in the food sector. The supply chain management, the value chain management, market integration, they are the ones which are of highly absorbable type to the, you know, women entrepreneurs. Let us find time, let us find theme for that to happen. As Madam was referring, India is the leading country with the startups. More than about 25,000 startups are there. Unfortunately, less than 5% are led by women. So here is an opportunity where we have to strengthen the women folk for really making them to be an independent. And when there is underrepresentation of the woman in the food sector, this is where we can able to bring in, reduce the gap of this woman involvement in the entrepreneur plan. Yes, our Honorable Prime Minister has made a call that vocal for local, which is also means voice for women. So this is where the dire need of the country and the experts and the science and the skill to promote that woman-based entrepreneurs. There are several, you know, already agencies, COWE, Confederation of Women Entrepreneurs, FIWE, Federation of Indian Women Entrepreneurs, Women Entrepreneurs Platform, they're all there. But now the question is, when these things are going to be taken as an institutional platform, fortunately also government is providing a lot of, you know, support programs, investment, like, you know, your Mahila ER, Saki, STEP, Nari Shakti Puraskars, Sukanya Samruddhi Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana scheme. So these are all been supported, aided by the engine of growth ministry, is the Ministry for Micro, Small and Medium Entrepreneurs. So this is the particular ministry supporting the promotion of these small entrepreneurs, wherein there is a lot of focus for the woman to be involved, and this become a torch bearer for the woman empowerment in the global and national platform. Now MSME is to be referred as, it is a platform and a ministry where it transforms the homemaker into an entrepreneur. So we are fortunate to have such a ministry in the country which is going to support the women entrepreneurs. In Karnataka State Women Development Corporation has come out with a Udyogini scheme wherein the representation of Madam like Chaya Nanjappa has been very actively involved in this program. And because of her involvement, now she has been given a lot of, you know, awards, rewards and representation at national level, state level and all. She has taken more than about six half dozen prime awards. Mention if you is, she is the Woman Entrepreneur of the Year. She is the president of the ABWBI. And she has also been given the Priyadarshini Award. And she was also been awarded as Woman Entrepreneur of the Year. Besides, she is the only lady where the woman-owned logo of a brand which has been established in our country. So that is how the woman entrepreneurs are going to support the promotion of this, you know, food-based industry. She is going to join the hand of, you know, band of Lalita Gupte, Kalpana Parporia, Anuraga, Kiran Majumdar Shandal. So they are all the, you know, other examples who have exemplary done in the field of food industry. Now, may now also suggest the speakers of this particular webinar that how best we can able to bring in the, you know, a platform where the unregistered sector of the woman are to be brought into the platform of registered ones. Where is the impact? Can we able to undertake an impact assessment of the existing policies and the schemes which can able to reveal a novel ways of woman entrepreneurs that is going to happen in the days to come? And how the woman entrepreneurship is a diverse complex which requires to be supplemented with the intense and extensive research to decode the dynamics of the, you know, woman entrepreneurship. I'm very sure that today's speakers, what I've listed there, they are going to enlighten us, they are going to give an outlook as to how a country, how a community can able to think on the promotion of this woman. Well, as rightly, indicated and been, you know, energized to all of us is that we have millions of problems. A country like India may have millions of problems, but at the same time, we have over billions of minds which are with us like, you know, the scientists and the faculties in the field, I'm sure that they are going to make a, you know, turnaround change in this industry. May I now request the honorable, you know, eminent speakers to take off their, you know, presentation, let them address these issues, and also enlighten as to how in days to come this particular sector is going to become the sunrise sector. So with these few words, I now call upon the director of CFTRI, Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, for our address on food processing opportunities for women entrepreneurs. Madam, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you very much for your kind words, and a very good evening to everybody present, all the dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. Indeed, it was a very scintillating address by the Honorable Minister for Women and Child Development, and it is a hard thing to follow. And I'll try my best to talk about the topic that has been suggested for the next 15 to 20 minutes. So, CFTRI is an institute that has been dedicated towards work and research on food science and technology. And it is the headquarters is situated in Mysore in the south of Karnataka. It was established in 1950 and continues to work very intensively in the area chosen. We also have regional centers in Mumbai, Lucknow, as well as Hyderabad. So coming to the topic, I thought I should start about women rather than the food industry. So if we look at women, the population is around 50% in the world. It is slightly lower in India, but globally, women are known to do more unpaid work and care than men. And even when they are paid for the work that they are carrying out, they are paid less. So if women have to be heard with respect and to also be part of the decision making, economic independence is extremely important. And this has been realized all over the world, and therefore the SDG also talks about gender equality. And another thing is, if only women, especially in countries like India, were to participate and have paid employment, the forecast increase in the GDP is predicted to be almost more than 25%. So it makes economic sense to involve women in entrepreneurship as well as other paid jobs. So what is the reason? One of the reasons is that it is easier for a woman to give up the job rather than the man. It could be to take care for the child or for a family member. And many times, because of her compulsions and not really being able to continue with work, what happens is that the perception is that she cannot reach higher. So often you find that even the establishment do not encourage women to reach higher, or sometimes she herself is diffident about it. So if you really look at the female population that is in the sector, that is working in formal sector, you hardly find 10% are represented by women. And as they go higher and higher, you find lesser and lesser women as leaders. So there is a lot of scope to not only boost the GDP, but it is extremely important to get different viewpoints. It is said that men think with their brains, whereas women think with their hearts. So it is extremely important to get both the viewpoints so that the picture is whole and very good decisions can be made. And this will overall improve the quality of life as well as happiness in our world. And like I said earlier, economic independence as well as decision making is very, very critical, not only at the family, but also at the national and global level. That is extremely important if we have to have a society that is not only happy, but also wholesome and is able to contribute to the best of their ability and as nature has designed them to. So traditionally, women have been good homemakers, and this is without doubt, I'm sure everybody will agree. But unfortunately, often they are not the decision makers because they are usually dependent financially on somebody else. And this happens because they are compromising on their jobs to take care of the family, which is more or less unpaid, and therefore it is not appreciated. And culturally, there has been a challenge to include them in the paid sector. And all of this put together has resulted in them being a little diffident in taking risks as well as decision making, because they have been dependent on somebody else to do this for them. They often, this also makes them ignorant about procedures. There is a lack of exposure, and therefore they could find it difficult to handle human resource, understand finance, or get government approvals that may be necessary in their entrepreneurship journey. Many times regulatory challenges would be there, or it could happen that they are not able to be as mobile as they would like to because of other compulsions. And often, like in some of the countries, even India, you find that male dominance is there. And all of this definitely leads to a lack of confidence, and therefore they are not considered seriously, even though they are having the capacity to perform and to go places. But again, globally, women want to do a wonderful job, and they try very hard to fulfill their duties. They actually multitask. Even if you look at all the gods in India, you find that the female gods are often having so many hands, and they don't have that many heads, but a lot of hands are there, which means that they are multitasking. They are very good learners, and they are efficient in their job because they cannot afford to while away the time. They are known to be natural nurturers, and this has come over generations, and therefore they love to innovate in the kitchen, and they have an inherent knowledge of food and nutrition that has been passed on from their mothers, grandmothers, and so on. So given this scenario where they have restricted mobility, there is a lack of exposure, sometimes even education to other fields, their commitment towards family, but an inherent knowledge of food and nutrition, probably entrepreneurship in the food sector is a very, very viable option for women. It is possible that they can contribute towards developing processes, maybe making products, even in the service sector like restaurants, the supply chain, they could be advisors of nutrition and so on. So coming to the food and beverage industry, globally, around 30% of the world economy is that. It is a huge trillion US dollar business. And definitely, if you look at India also, like the earlier speakers, including the Honorable Minister, said we are number one or two in most of the agricultural produce and also animal protein. But however, the processing is very low as compared to the other countries. In fact, although it is growing at a very fast pace, as was mentioned by Director IAFPT, we still lag behind a lot of even other Southeast Asian countries in the way we process the food. So we have the potential to be the largest food suppliers to the world as well as the domestic market. And this is even more important because most of our people are actually dependent on agriculture as a livelihood, and they are contributing a lot towards our GDP. Therefore, food processing is a very, very viable possibility for women entrepreneurs. And the beauty of it is that it can be micro, it can be scalable to small, medium, or even large, depending on what kind of processing, what is the demand, and how much of investment is possible by the person concerned. So I would only restrict to a few top trends. Of course, Dr. Anand Ramakrishnan did mention a lot more, but due to paucity of time, I thought I will just talk about these, which are why the food industry came into the being in the first place. The very first is convenience. We have been processing food because it is convenient to us. And today's world, where the women especially are going out to work, it has become all the more necessary, because most of us want to have the traditional taste. And we all know that processing of Indian food is a very cumbersome thing. And therefore, convenience is a very, very important factor. Then, as food is definitely eaten for the nutrition that it gives. However, as again said earlier, a personalized nutrition as well as specific to targeted population is the buzzword. The reason is we have all realized, even science has found that it is very, very important to understand the genomic, metabolomic responses and eat those foods. And that diet will decide how healthy we are and for how long we remain healthy. It is also dependent on our age. It depends on the gender. It depends on the lifestyle that we are having, as well as at which stage of the life cycle we are in. Recently, a lot of debating and a lot of understanding has happened about food as a health factor. Many of the minor constituents of food, which were earlier thought to have no role to play, today we realize that they are actually important for us to maintain good health. And this is also true for plant-based foods. And of course, a lot has been told about sustainability and reduction of waste. No longer we can afford to be linear in the food industry. It has to be a circular economy, and we have to find ways of utilizing the byproducts as well as reducing the greenhouse gases and carbon footprint so that we are able to have a sustainable industry. And given the kind of money that is available today and the independence and the curiosity, new flavors and experiences are also part of the food industry today. So coming to convenience foods, of course, it, as the name suggests, you have to produce, it provides convenience because it reduces the drudgery and it gives a novelty to the housewives or whoever is the provider of food in the community or house. And further, when you have foods that are ready to cook, there is also a satisfaction of being a little novel by adding other kinds of ingredients to that. And at the same time, it is homemade. So there is a satisfaction that the person who is feeding the family or the community feels that they have made it themselves. And of course, like I said earlier, traditional dishes can be made easily and they have a good shelf life, and there is a huge export market potential because there are many, many people who are globetrotting, but they would like to have their traditional taste to take with them wherever they go. And like it was mentioned earlier, the market value is huge and it is growing. Especially even in the snacks mixes, you find that there is a double digit growth that is being seen, and it includes a variety of products. It could be instant mixes or bakery items, frozen foods, desserts, juices, and all of this can be taken up in the micro scale, small scale, medium or large scale by women entrepreneurs. And they can also add a dash of their own ingenuity by using their recipe that they have and creating a unique selling point. So in the area of fruits, for example, they could be providing ingredients which could go from B2B or it could come to the consumer in the form of cordials or nectars or crushes and flakes and so on. And it also gives a very nice opportunity because especially in India, you find that many of the fruits are seasonal and they're not really available to everybody all throughout the year, nor throughout the country. So by processing these kind of products, we are able to popularize them. We are able to also make sure that they are available to people who would otherwise never have to see them or taste them. So there is a scope for globalization of many of the local produce if we are able to process these. And no better than women entrepreneurs can take this up, because many of these products really do not also require too much of machinery or automation. Although at large scale, it may be necessary, but when you are doing at the medium scale, even not too much of equipment is required and the skill can be imparted. So coming to the nutrition, health and wellness, again, there is a growing population throughout the world which is suffering from malnutrition. So on the one hand, you have a large number of people who are suffering from undernutrition, be it protein calorie, or you have them having the hidden hunger, which is micronutrient deficiency. There is a large population in India, nearly 70% of the women in the reproductive age are known to be anemic. There is a large number of child population under the age of 5 who are also anemic, and this not only puts a health burden on the system, but also it will compromise on their life savings and the amount of output that they can do. Nearly 10 years of their work output could be affected if they are severely anemic. And it is very important because the cost of prevention is far better and is much cheaper to the country than if you have to cure it. On the other hand, we are seeing a large number of overweight and obese people. This has especially been increasing because of the sedentary lifestyle, the kind of stress levels in the urban population, and doing sedentary jobs by sitting on the chair for the whole day and eating the right wrong kind of foods. Many of us are eating the wrong foods. We are eating only calories, we are eating protein, but we are not really getting vitamins and minerals. And therefore, there is a problem in the metabolic disorders that we are seeing, especially after the age of 40. Many of us are ending up with cardiovascular disease. There could be diabetes. 1 in 4 Indians is estimated to become diabetic or is already pre-diabetic. We are the global leaders of cardiovascular disease and so on. So there is a huge, huge potential for using food as a means of preventing lifestyle diseases. And all of it can be made in our country also, because we have this huge treasure and database of Ayurveda as well as traditional knowledge. And the world over, this nutraceutical market is growing. And again, it is 18% in India. Many of us are looking at we are looking for solutions as a prevention and not as a cure. So it has become a more positive outlook. We don't want to get into a disease condition and use a drug to solve it. Of course, many of the families are also now very small, and there are nobody to take care if somebody were to fall sick. So it is a huge market and there is a huge potential. Many of the women folk do have a lot of traditional knowledge that has been passed on in the generation in their homes or in their communities, which can be put to use. Definitely, there is a need for us to scientifically validate these claims, and only then we can have a market and we can pass the regulations as well as have an export market. But surely we have to do it and not any multinational. And this knowledge is there in India, as is there probably in many other countries, including Africa, where they may have their own set of ideas as well as knowledge that is passed on. And we need to do it, and that would give a very good income back to our women entrepreneurs and our economy. And like I said, the validation of the claims are missing, which is absolutely important. Therefore, scientifically, we need to validate these claims and understand the mode of action at the molecular and the metabolic level, so that the world accepts that, yes, there is a wellness criteria to this. And again, many of us, especially the pandemic, has made us realize that we should go back to our traditional diets. Apart from, of course, in India, because of the huge number of people who are getting diabetic or who are getting into cardiovascular problems. So millets have been rediscovered. They are grains that do not need as much water as rice. And definitely they are healthy because the whole grain is used. It is not too much of polishing is done, unlike rice, where we are eating only the starch. And this starch is easily digestible, and therefore there is a spurt in the amount of glucose that is released on consumption. Whereas the carbohydrate that is there in millets is quite complex, and therefore the glycemic index is lower. Add to that the higher amount of polyphenols that are there definitely help to hinder the absorption, especially for women. The problem is that, as well as adults. Now, the problem is that although they are available in a large scale, but they are in certain regions only. And today they are being called nutri-cereals, and there is a lot of impetus because the International Year of Millets has been declared as 2023. We need to develop specific machinery for processing because of the size of the grain, the shape of the grain, the very property and nature of these grains. We need to have specific machines because many of these grains also have a lipase in them, which can make and affect the shelf life of these products that are there. So if we are looking at long shelf life as well as a good sensory characteristic, and both for the domestic and export market, we have to address the issue of not only the way we process these grains, but also to remove activities like lipase, which can affect the shelf life and will make it sensorily unacceptable. Of course, there is a lack of awareness, though today it is far, far better than it used to be. Nevertheless, we need to do more work to understand the different kinds of processing. Maybe it is popping, maybe flaking, maybe fermentation, maybe germination. What is it that is happening to the nutritive value of these millets? And is it a complete kind of a nutrition that we are getting? Maybe some of the proteins that are there are lacking in one or more of the essential amino acids, which need to come from the diet. So we may need to mix and match. Another very important thing about millets is that they are gluten-free. And we know today that 1 in 100 in Indians are actually having gluten intolerance and suffering from celiac disease, though they do not know that. So this is one such opportunity where we can have very niche market and create a niche market for our particular foods. And there are a lot of health benefits that have been attributed towards millets. Again, like I said, we need to scientifically validate the claim. So definitely we are heading towards personalized nutrition. Especially in India, we do not see these specific kind of products on our shelves. And there is a need for creating them. including low glycemic foods, gluten-free foods, foods especially for sports persons. Recently, when there was the Olympics, all of us were rooting for our athletes to get a lot of gold medals. Unless they get the right kind of nutrition, their performance is going to be hindered. Therefore, we have a responsibility to make sure that they get the right kind of nutrition. There is a sizable population that requires therapeutic foods. There are people who are obese, like I said, which require low-calorie foods, and maybe under specific conditions, somebody is convalescing, maybe somebody has a kidney problem. All of this, we need to have special foods, and there is a huge opportunity over here for us to create these foods for the Indian market and thereon expand to the global market. And it is, again, many of these foods also can have the nutraceuticals, because the food itself is becoming the medicine. And these nutraceuticals, what are there in these functional foods, is again a huge $1 billion market. And it is growing again at a very fast pace, including during the pandemic. So there is a wide range of products that can be made, and many of these were also developed at CSER, CFTRI, and they are low-cost technologies which have been transferred to many entrepreneurs, and all of these are off the shelf. And because we are a public supported institute, there is nothing like exclusivity, and anybody can come and take these technologies from us. And definitely we handhold them when they are setting up. We also have an incubation center where people can actually incubate themselves to see the market survey, as well as use our equipment to make their products, and finally go out when they are ready to do so and set up their own plant. The wellness economy also is very, very, it's a $1 trillion market. And in that, you will find that health and nutrition products are also having a very, very substantial market. And given our traditional knowledge and the knowledge of Ayurveda, there is a huge scope for us to have very indigenous products that could be exported or for the domestic market. Like I said earlier, it is important that the claims be scientifically validated. So some of the nutraceuticals that have been worked on very well and reported in literature include all of these. It could be they are from plants, they could be from microbes, they could be from algae. All of them are also bioactive components, because they are bringing about some activity within our body. This could include antioxidant activity, or it could be anti-cancer and so on. Many of the plant metabolites are actually found in many of our foods, especially the traditional foods, and they are today reported to either prevent or at least manage diseases like diabetes, heart disease. And one very, very important area that has come up recently is our gastrointestinal health. The gut microbiome is known to be the second brain today, it is called, because it is our gut microbiome which is going to actually determine how healthy we are going to be, or how unhealthy we could become, or what disease we could have. So there are specific nutraceuticals that could promote the growth of the good bacteria and make our gut microbiome healthy, and therefore we can live a healthier life for a longer period of time. So, like again mentioned earlier, this is one of the biggest sectors of the food industry that is growing very, very fast. The vegan foods, vegan milk, vegan meat, that is the meat analogs, hydrolysates, all of these are really exploding in the marketplace. And we are getting, even in India, there are a lot of startups which are trying to harness plant proteins. Now, one of the problems is that most of our plant sources, be it pulses or be it oil seeds, the protein content is around 20% because they are seeds and they are meant to be broken down. The proteins are to be broken down when the plant is actually growing. That is, the seedling is germinating. Many of these proteins are very high molecular weight and they are difficult to break down. So often you see that the recovery of these proteins does not go more than 50%. So currently we are 20%, which means that currently our recovery rates are low and therefore the products become expensive. But nevertheless, more and more work is being done, and I'm sure in the next few years we are going to see very competitive products even in India. They are already started, but more and more products are going to come in. Again, the global vegan market is growing in leaps and bounds. I've already spoken about millets. One thing is that millets or these vegan foods are actually consumer driven. They have created a demand, and therefore the food industry has to actually make them and serve this demand. So again, here also there are many, many seeds and grains that are underutilized in countries like Africa as well as India. They are more region specific, and a lot of work can be done, and these could be harnessed. For all we know, many of the seed proteins are actually lacking in lysine, which is an essential amino acid. For all we know, there could be some seeds which are region specific and underutilized, which could be very rich in lysine, and therefore they could be added to another protein to make it a complete protein, thereby eliminating the need of any animal protein to be consumed at all in the coming days. Again, we have specific markets for protein foods for targeted population, be it in the area of infant foods, sports nutrition, enteric nutrition, geriatric nutrition, convalescents, maybe people who are in, suffering from kidney disease, and many, many more. All of these are million, multi-billion to multi-billion dollar industries. And the protein here has to be very specific. For example, for infants, you need to have an easily digestible protein. So hydrolysates could be one way to go. For sports nutrition, you often find that branch chain amino acids are required in larger quantity, and therefore a food needs to be designed to have more branch chain amino acids and arginine. And similarly, if you're looking at special diets also, then specific foods are required so that absorption is better. So there is a huge demand, and currently there are not too many foods that are available in the market which are addressing these things, except maybe in the field of infant nutrition. Again, much has been told about meat analogs. The one thing that what is driving this is because it is environmentally friendly. A lot of people are worried about the carbon footprint and the amount of water that is required to actually grow these animals before they are able to become food for humans. So a lot of plant proteins as well as algal proteins and all are being looked at to understand if these can be good substitutes. In fact, one such technology that has been developed by CFTRI includes spirulina, and there are other foods. Today, these have become the rage, especially of the younger people, because they are curious to try new foods and like insect proteins, and they are much, much easier to grow, and they give per gram more protein, more calcium, more iron. So maybe they could be the way to go forward to address the undernutrition also.
My request is to kindly.
Yes, I'm coming to the end of whatever. I'm coming to the end of my talk. So this is the last part where environmentally we have to be sustainable. Like there are many ways of doing it, including getting natural bioactives from the byproduct streams of many of our food processing. So some of the advice includes that you have to be sure about your idea and please come to a person or an institute because there are a large number of avenues available so that the problem can be sorted out with skill and with help. And of course, there are a lot of also government incentives that are given. There are many, many success stories that are there in our country alone. Only two I have picked up over here. And like was already mentioned, very few women are there in our startups. And this, the government has recognized and many of the schemes have been introduced. And definitely research institutes have been skilling women and empowering them so that they can become entrepreneurs. Even in as an association or as a individual. So these are some of the pictures that show how they can be empowered and they're very fast to catch on and they get additional income too. So these are some of the incubators even in the urban setup. Thank you. Thank you very much for
thank you, madam. Here. Thank you. Yeah. It was a very enlightened address by Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, wherein we know the women are really the heroes in the food sector, and also the prospects of the new dimensions of nutraceuticals and prevention of the approach of the food style and everything was been very very impressively and with a lot of facts and with science based things madam has explained. Madam, on behalf of the participants, I'm really thankful to you for the enlightened discussion. Had we had much more time to have interaction, but for want of time, now may I request the other speaker, Mr. Bharanidharan Ramaswamy. He will be speaking on importance of continuous quality and ethics in business. I request you to kindly, since the time has been passed, I request you to kindly highlight your presentations to not exceeding 7 minutes.
Thank you so much.
Please.
Can you all hear me?
Please go ahead.
Okay, good evening. And it's a pleasure to really listen to all the panelists and I am Bharanidharan Ramaswamy. I represent Marriott International Procurement. I will try to complete my presentation in 7 minutes as requested. Okay, so I take care of the India and Asia Pacific procurement. And just to give a kind of, this is the agenda of the whole meeting. We'll talk about the Marriott, we'll quickly talk about the quality and ethics, what we follow in Marriott, which obviously we expect our supply partners to be adhered to. And also we talk about certain opportunities, what is connected in Marriott. So globally, Marriott has business in more than 130 plus countries and 7,000 hotels across the globe with 30 different brands. So there are many brands, people will think it's not part of Marriott, but it's actually part of Marriott, like Tribute or Four Point or Ritz-Carlton, Sheraton, many things. And in India, we have more than 120 plus hotels. And I'm just going to focus quickly on, like when it comes to quality and ethics, the Marriott Supplier Code of Conduct. So which I would like to really emphasize and spend a couple of minutes here before moving to other slides. So honesty and integrity is not just specific to procurement, it's truly, or not specific to supply partners, it's specific to every activity what you do in the business. And the compliance to applicable laws is what actually we extremely sensitive about every supply partner to be adherence to, and the responsible sourcing. It's not only that where we are sourcing from, we also expect that our supply partners to really source from the right partners, and it's been sourced in the right way. And also like ethical behavior and no child labor, which is something is very important that our supply partners are adhered to certain close community engagement management, along with having ethical behavior and in terms of their daily activities and in terms of daily business approach what they do. while also providing, like as our minister specified about the safety and health, healthy workplace for the employees. That's something what we normally look at it. And there are ethical recruitment planning, like, it's very important that we ensure that, there is a kind of the employees who are recruited in a right manner, and also they have been treated well, and freedom of association, what we look at it, and like avoiding forced labor. And also, like, specifically one of the very important is that how as we are supporting our diverse supply partners and how our suppliers are also engaging with diverse supply partners. So I know that it's because of the lack of the time, I'm trying to just quickly run through. These are all something is very basic fundamentals of what we look at it. And also it's very important for any supply partner to ensure that when they follow some of these practices, it is sustainable, it's long-term, and it's going to be a kind of big opportunity for them to grow big in the future. And to ensure that these processes are actually followed, there are many, like, I'm sure it's not only Marriott, many organizations, have this internal controls and measures, which actually helps, each of the supply partner to learn and, educate and then grow along with the organization. We do have committees to really shortlist certain categories, like based on the food or non-food, we form committees, and then those committees decide and then give and hand-holding out to the whole supply partners on how to really grow with Marriott. We conduct certain annual tender process where supplier partners can participate in the annual tender process. There are newspaper advertisements, what we actually, give it on the newspaper, and then people can openly come and participate in the tender process. We to ensure that the whole process is done, we follow sealed bid process, to ensure that there is a transparency and there's also a confidentiality is maintained. And there are yield tests are conducted and blind tastings are conducted. So it is not just about the commercials. We also look at the various parameters. We have about internal scoring of more than 35 different parameters to look at it for when we select a particular supplier for the food products. So also like blind tasting, we look for lab test reports. Also, we conduct the supplier audits. Like when we do a supplier audit, we educate the supply partners to in what way they can grow and then groom over a period of time in all the aspects of their overall production and also supply chain. So insurance is something what we normally encourage some of our supply partners to get adhered to, so that it is a protection for them. And quality certifications, as one of our previous panelists explained the importance of this. So it's very important for every supply partner to really focus on the quality certification. And of course, there are various contract terms we normally agree upon, and to maintain a continuous improvement, there's a performance assessment as being done. So these are the quick, points to really cover about. However, I will just rush through. Marriott is globally is spending, we spend about more than $5 billion on women owned entrepreneurs, LGBT, minority, veteran and disability. So we completely support, we give a kind of, opportunity, fair opportunity for all these categories of business entrepreneurs. So we genuinely wanted to globally support, and at every country level, we support these, entrepreneurs from this background. Like we have an internal standard called MIP 42, where the every RFP, beyond a particular value, where we ensure that the LGBT women, people with disability and minorities are included in the RFP bid process, and they are given a fair opportunity to be part of the Marriott, procurement, activities. And of course, quickly to just rush through with the short of time, like if you look at it in India, like over a period of time, this is mainly on the women-owned entrepreneurs. In 2016, we were working with 147 supply partners. Today, we are working with 603 supply partners. So these are all the suppliers, and surely because of the pandemic, there's a little slowness in terms of the active participation of the active business involvement with the supplier. However, the number of suppliers who are registered, women entrepreneurs registered with us, are more than 600 plus with Marriott. This is something is what we continue monitoring, and then we keep, continue improving on this area. Like some of the categories, what we spend is, if you look at it, there are domestic food, there are soft beverages, there are imported foods, dairy products, dry fruits, linen and non-food products, various categories where there is a kind of, the women entrepreneurs are closely associated with Marriott, across different hotels. It's not specific to city location. Like it's not that just, we work with some people only in Mumbai or Bangalore, we work with even a smaller city locations as well. So we encourage, there's a huge opportunities available in the hospitality industry. People can surely look at it as one of the opportunity. Like we also conduct in the conferences, we involve the women entrepreneurs where they come and they participate, they interact with the procurement managers and the hotel team, and then so that they can represent their present their products and categories. So these are some of the quick categories. What actually we actually you know use, like, there are many services, many food and non-food products. Actually, I think, you know, these categories are more general in nature. I think, as some of our previous panelists have explained, there's a huge opportunity. You know, every opportunity can be just, you know, looked into a kind of just only approaching a kind of right method of, you know, trending, participating in the, you know, procurement process of, you know, different hospitality industry. So that's it. I think I could able to meet the timeline of 7 minutes, and so yeah, I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah, Mr. Muralidharan, well done, very crisp and apt.
Paranidharan.
So you could able to, you know, restrict your presentation very aptly, and yeah, and your presentation was, you know, ethics is the business nerve. So that's what the message you have given to us, and I'm sure that the protocols what you have developed would be emulated in the food industry in days to come. Well done, Mr. Muralidharan.
Yeah,
now may Sir Girish Mohan, is he online? Organizers, can you able to check for the availability of Mr. Girish Mohan?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. He is there.
Well.
Hi. Good evening.
Welcome, Mr. Girish Mohan.
Yeah, good evening. So I'll be really brief in my talk because we have already overshooten the time. Very briefly about ITC, we are one of a major food business player actually in India, with more than 100 years of history now. But here I'm not, to talk about the food sector, because I come from a different background, different work. I look after associate investment functions of ITC. So I'll talk about the kind of work we do in empowerment, and generally dwell upon the kind of growth and issues that we India as a society faces, and then what many entrepreneur, many corporates can do. So going ahead, I think we are aware about the kind of growth we have witnessed. All the speakers are talking about the kind of opportunities that exist, the kind of economic growth that we have seen. If you see last 30 years, we can understand the kind of inequalities that exist in our country. If we compare our country with many other countries, we are only next to Russia in terms of inequality, where top 1% basically acquired 10% of the 10% or more income, and this gap is getting widening day by day. Between 1990 and 2015, you can see it has gone to 20%. It's not just that this gap is between rural and urban areas. Within rural area also, if you see, we have more than 26 crores of households which are involved in farming activity. So 54% of them are marginal. So it limits their capacity to invest in agriculture, as well as in post-harvest technologies, where a lot of food, a lot of grain get wasted. Within a farming community also, within farmers also, there is huge disparity. More than 86% are marginal farmer, and this gap increases day by day. So the question is it really a matter of concern for entrepreneurs, for businesses? Simple answer is yes, because if you are looking for long-term businesses, if we want ourselves to be entrepreneurs for future, I think this is a cause of concern, because businesses can't survive in societies which are not stable, where there is a high disparity which exists. Just dwell upon these female labor force participation. I think Dr. Sridevi also touched it very briefly. although the traditional wisdom says that with growing economy, there is income level, there is education level which increases, but and so is women force participation in labor force. But if you see India case, it's something else, the story where you know, there has been a steady decrease in women participation. There could be several reasons. I'm not getting into those reasons, but the question in front of all of us is that what can we do as a business entity, as a entrepreneur, to address this issue? Government has taken its own steps. It has adopted 17 sustainable development goals, out of which two goals specifically focused and targeted on reducing inequality. In ITC, basically, you know, we feel that businesses have a larger purpose. It's not just creating wealth for creating economic value for shareholder mainly, but if we can widen our scope of value creation, focus on larger societal value creation rather than just focusing on shareholder value creation, we can deliver not only economic value, but also can deliver social and environmental value. And this philosophy helps us to adopt triple bottom line approach, which help us to become carbon positive, water positive, and solid waste recycling positive company. So if you look at the ecosystem of women entrepreneurs in India, there has been definitely a growth, but compared to overall numbers, women entrepreneurs growing year on year has been very less. The good news is that growth has been almost double in agri sector, agri and allied sector, from 15.7% in 2005 to around 34%, which is double. But the bad news is that its share in rural area has gone down compared to what is happening in urban area. So it's a challenge, because agriculture is the primary and major sector for the growth of India. If we don't address this gap, if we don't you know, take corrective actions, probably we will, you know, we will have a growth where one section of society is lagging behind, which is not good for anyone, including businesses. Dr. Siridevi also talked about various barriers. I'll not get into those barriers. One major barriers is the finance, where you can see, as per this report, 79% of women business are self-financed. So it limits their capacity to create wealth and their capacity to expand. So the answer is that we can have an approach where we address, you know, four pillars, which are improving skills, enhancing external support, addressing gender biases, and creating a linkages with the market or with the financial sector. Government have, for example, government has Mudra scheme. Unfortunately, many of women folk, they don't even know about the scheme. So corporate, as a responsible entity of country, can work on these areas. Sometime back in 2015-16, we did this kind of experiment in one of our value chain area, where we organized almost 106 women into four nursery groups, gave them initial loan from project side, and these become part of our value chain, where they are now supplying sapling to our own paper business. And till date, they have done a business of cumulatively 31 million Indian rupees. So in conclusion, I think women entrepreneur is one area which, if we can address as a society, we were talking, Honorable Session Chair was also talking about, you know, this can increase our growth rate. In fact, we can become a double digit economy if we address this issue. The question is, who will address this? In our opinion, that it's a collective responsibility of government, society, research organization, and corporate entrepreneurs, etc. Thank you very much for your patience hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Girish Mohan. Very timely and apt issues you have covering with respect to the, you know, agribusiness issues relating to SDG 2 and SDG 5, and also the prospects of the woman involvement into the agribusiness in days to come has been enlightened with your own experience. We are really, you know, enlightened as to how your corporation is going to, you know, drive home the message of, you know, how the rural folk, rural women could able to be a part of this type of industries. Well, with this, I think to begin with, we had the session from Dr. Ananda Ramakrishnan. That was over. Now, with this, I could proudly say that all the speakers have given their valued insights. These insights were by and large onto the requirements of the honorable chief guest expectations. I'm sure the deliberations, discussions happened here will be recorded aptly, and I'm sure that ABWCI chairman, country president, Mrs. Chaya Nanjappa Rajappa is going to consolidate, and she'll be communicating and circulating for the wider use of these, you know, deliberations and discussions. I'm sure by the time we conduct next similar such food processing opportunities supported with human entrepreneurs, this today's webinar has a greater bearing on taking it further for actual things to happen at the field level. For that, I request Chaya Nanjappa, the country president, to see to that many more human entrepreneur activities are to be promoted, as informed by chief guest, by the already existing ample programs of MSME. And it is right time for us to integrate, converge the institutional platform like IIPFT, CFTRI, and other corporate sectors who are all in the food sector. I'm sure over a period of time, maybe very soon, we should be able to reach out in bringing the gap between the woman, the female involvement into the food sector and agriculture sector per se. Well, with these few words, I'm thankful to the organizers of ABWCI, especially Madam Chaya, and also the director of Institute of Food Processing Technology, Dr. Ananda Ramakrishnan, for having taken the initiative to conduct this type of seminars. Thank you, all the speakers, for having, you know, very aptly said. Once again, I thank Dr. Sridevi Annapurna Singh, Mr. Bharanidharan Ramaswamy, Dr. C. Ananda Ramakrishnan, Mr. Girish Mohan, and Madam Mrs. Chaya Nanjappa for their involvement, interest, and commitment in this, you know, conduct of the seminar. On behalf of myself, I'm thankful to all of you for having cooperated in conducting things. Kindly bear with us for having extended some 15 minutes, but it was a very useful thing. I acknowledge and I appreciate all the participation. Thank you, one and all. Good
Thank
evening.
You, Dr. Maheshwar, sir. So with this, we came to the end of this virtual workshop. So I would like to express our sincere gratitude for Chief Guest, Srimati Smriti Irani Madam, and all the distinguished guests, as well as the eminent speakers who graced today's workshop with their thoughtful words. And I hope we will work together for the empowerment and upgradation of the women entrepreneurs in our country. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thanks a ton. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for everyone.
Thank you all. Thank you so much.